All right. Well, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Again, we greatly appreciate you coming together today. We'd like to be able to call the Joint Committee on Fisheries and Aquaculture together and to order. It is our 42nd year, and we greatly appreciate all of you attending. And on behalf of Vice Chair Assemblymember Wood, along with all the other members who will be seen coming in and out throughout the day, we are grateful that you would attend our 42nd annual meeting. We'd like to be able to offer a few opening remarks, turn it over to the Vice Chair to open the hearing as well, and then we're going to be getting right into the discussion today on fish flows and marijuana grows. For the past four decades per statute, the committee has convened to provide a state of the California fisheries with annual reports from the natural resource agencies, professional fishing and aquaculture organizations, and those individuals who are at the heart of the $7 billion California commercial fishing industry and the $2 billion sport and recreational fishing industry, the fishermen. There have been very few times over this committee's 40-year history that California's fisheries have faced such daunting challenges, such as the year we are currently witnessing. Our state is reeling from the fourth year of this historic drought, and almost every watershed across this state is facing declining conditions, including the mightiest of the California rivers, such as the Sacramento, the Klamath, the Russian, the San Joaquin, and the Eel. The once robust salmon populations are now struggling to survive. We are facing a potential fishery disaster across California. Our magnificent, iconic fish populations have gone from abundance to scarcity, and they have declined to the point of becoming threatened or endangered species in one lifetime. Compounding what many call a crisis for our fisheries is the fact that one of our state's largest crops, marijuana, has seen explosive growth since the passage of Proposition 215, which legalized medical consumption of cannabis, and that was back in 1996. Left virtually unregulated for nearly two decades now, tens of thousands of acres of marijuana are now literally sucking rivers dry due to significantly decreased flow conditions because of the drought and illegal water diversions benefiting vast fields of marijuana grows. These grows are now the number one source of sediment in Northern California rivers and watersheds. They're the number one source of nutrient loads in Northern California rivers. And thousands of acres of California forests have been illegally cleared. Hence the title of our hearing, Fish Flows and Marijuana Grows. Working with Assemblymember Wood, and I do appreciate all of his work on this issue. And Assemblyman, thank you so much for joining us. It's really good to see you, sir. Thank you. We represent the Senate District, which includes 40% of California's magnificent coast, from the Golden Gate Bridge to the Oregon border. Our districts are home to most of the remaining healthy salmon populations in the state. But all of these populations are currently facing a crisis, likely the most severe in California's history because of the drought and because our district produces the majority of the cannabis sold in the United States. And there are growers, not all I might add, the vast majority want regulations to be able to comply with, and the vast majority have been farming cannabis for two to three generations. But left unregulated for 20 years, there is a minority population of growers that disregard the environment for the reward of personal profit. And I do want to welcome the Assemblyman. Thank you so much for being here. Fishing has always been a way of life in California, and it's home to approximately a dozen fishing ports in communities whose health, vitality, and economies rely on robust fisheries, which is why we must work together to ensure its success for future generations. Salmon in California are integral part of our state's history, and fishing is one of our oldest industries in the state. Fish along our coast were the mainstay of the diet of native peoples for over 10,000 years and played an important role in feeding the miners headed for the gold fields. These once robust populations are simply part of the history books now. We must take action to protect the few remaining healthy stocks of salmon left, especially in the face of this brutal four-year drought. Many rivers and tributaries and watersheds are going dry, and in other cases, warm water temperatures due to significantly reduced flows are breeding grounds for disease that impact fish, and as we all know, fish need cold water to thrive, and that cold water has been a diminishing resource. In 2014, decisions were made that resulted in killing 95% of our endangered winter run Chinook salmon and likely a similar percentage of fall Chinook on the Sacramento River. We cannot allow that to happen again. Our salmon fisheries are severely constrained or simply closed in order to protect winter run numbers. But fact is, the fall run is the bread and butter of our fishery, which dramatically impacts our state's economy along the entire West Coast as well, all the way up to Canada. We are now being forced to choose which of these fish will live, knowing that many will die. The strain on our watersheds and also our hatcheries have never been so severe. And as we work to respond to four consecutive dry years and the needs of our burgeoning population of almost 40 million people continues to grow, we must also remain committed to protecting our environment, our fisheries and the families, jobs and the communities that depend on them. It's about balance. And I know that our state agencies, who we're grateful who are here today, are desperately trying to avoid such devastating losses this year and prevent fishery closures as we've experienced in recent past. But this drought, exacerbated by rogue marijuana grows, is providing to be a challenging opponent. Today's hearing has brought together some of the smartest fishery experts in the West. You're going to hear from agency heads, industry leaders, and those on the ground who are fighting back against the bone-dry conditions impacting our state's watersheds. And we'll also hear about the impacts of rogue marijuana grows are having throughout this state. Our all-star panelists won't simply identify problems today. They're also going to be talking about potential administrative and legislative solutions that may prevent additional die-offs and expedite recovery of our fisheries throughout California. We look forward to a constructive discussion on how to protect and restore our watersheds and fishery populations while dealing with the disasters of drought and rogue marijuana grows. Public participation is an important part of today's forum, and we're going to be taking comment after our third panel, and we really want to hear from you today. And again, we're grateful that you would take so much time to be with us. We'd like to be able to allow members of our committee to offer opening remarks. And again, I just want to say thank you to our Vice Chair, Assemblymember Jim Wood, who is here, who will kick it off. And then we're going to turn it over to the other Assembly members if they would also like to offer some opening remarks. Mr. Wood.
Great. Thank you, Senator McGuire. And it is indeed an honor to be here today to learn from you. This is a learning experience for us. It's an opportunity to air some of the issues that you have of concern. While this topic today focuses around marijuana and water flows and watershed, rest assured that these are not the only issues we know that are affecting the fisheries and our aquaculture out there, and we will be focusing on those as well. There are significant challenges related to the drought, obviously. There are significant challenges just in environmental restoration of watershed that we need to tackle. There are numerous issues, and I just want to assure people that while this topic today is around marijuana and water flows, that we are aware of the other issues. And as we move forward with this committee in the future, we will begin to dig into those other topics as well. I think that seeing is believing, and I think you're going to see some things here today, and you're going to hear some things here today that, quite frankly, ought to be shocking to you. I experienced firsthand last week in the North Coast, in the Emerald Triangle, some things that I found absolutely shocking, and you will hear some of that, I think, from Sheriff Allman later today. First and foremost to me, some of the environmental damage that is happening, whether it is by design or simply by ignorance, for not understanding why roads should be constructed a certain way, why ponds should be constructed a certain way, why you shouldn't be diverting water, why you shouldn't be fencing off springs to keep wildlife out. Those are huge, huge issues. And just in the efforts, and I won't steal Sheriff Allman's thunder on this, the amount of water that is being diverted is absolutely staggering, and the impact on our fisheries is absolutely disastrous from my perspective. We have to get a handle on this, and I look forward to hearing from you today. Like I said, you're going to hear some things today, you're going to see some things that I hope leave you with the impression that we have a lot of work to do, and we need to do it as quickly as we can. So it's an honor to be here working with Senator McGuire on this issue. We share, my assembly district is nested completely with him. While he represents 40% of the coastline, I only get 33%. While he represents seven counties, I only get five. But everything he represents, I represent. So our problems are inextricably commingled. But it's an honor to be here today, and I will send this back to the senator to make some other introductions.
Now, thank you, Simon, and a really good partnership, so thank you so much, sir. We'd like to turn to our right and see if the assembly members would like to be able to offer any opening remarks, and we're grateful to the two of you for being here and for your service.
Thank you. I think you both did a great job covering the bases. Looking forward to the meeting.
Thank you so much, Simon. Assembly member.
Yeah, thank you very much, Senator, for calling this hearing. And to Vice Chair Wood, your comments, both of you, were really on target as to some of the issues that we're facing, particularly in this drought. So the drought's not new. We've had it now for 4 years. We don't know how much longer it will go. And the impacts of the drought are being felt very, very much by people who are going to be presenting here today, both obviously the impacts of the fisheries, but also for those who have tried to adapt to the drought over the years in agriculture and ranching, and I'm glad that they are participating today as well. This is some of the issues that we're going to be identifying have been a problem for a very long time, not just because of the drought, but the drought gives us an opportunity to raise concerns about the environmental damage and the diversion of water from the uses that it should otherwise be going, legally, environmentally, and to protect our ecosystem, which is our long-term concern that we're going to be concerned about long past this drought, and that we should be able to protect throughout that drought if people follow the rules. So thank you very much, Senator, Vice Chair Wood. Grateful for your leadership on this issue.
It's really good to see you, sir, and thank you so much for being here, both of you. Thank you. The Joint Committee on Fisheries and Aquaculture annually recognizes an individual who has made a significant impact to the industry. And this year, we want to recognize a true legend, and that's Zeke Grader. Mr. Grader was honored at a special event held in Sausalito, and that event celebrated his four decades of service to the fish, fishermen, and fishing communities here in California. Zeke isn't able to be here today. He really wanted to be. He does have some health challenges. And this is what we were going back into the books. We think this is his first hearing that he's ever missed. He is a founder, along with Mr. Keene, former senator, of this joint committee. And our thoughts and prayers are with him and his family today. And I got to say, we are forever indebted to Zeke, and extremely grateful for his lifelong commitment to healthy fisheries across this state. And I think we need to give him a round of applause. Again, we appreciate all of you traveling here today. There will be a light lunch provided, some housekeeping here, at 12:30, which I think Secretary Laird's going to be coming back for. He loves his Subway. Am I right, Secretary? Absolutely. All right. Hey, there we go. I'm giving him a hard time. But we'll continue to work through lunch and want to make sure that all of you are able to stay refreshed. And I also want to say thank you to the gentleman to my right. This is Tom Weslow. He is chief consultant to the committee. And Mr. Weslow has done an amazing job, as he always does, preparing this hearing and getting folks organized. And I just want to say thank you so much, Mr. Weslow, for all of your efforts and for all the hard work that went into today. So thank you so much, Tom, and it's really good to see you, sir. So let's kick it off. Yeah, let's give him a round of applause. Absolutely. It is truly an honor to have our first speaker here today. I would like to be able to invite the Secretary of Natural Resources to please come forward. Mr. Laird has nearly four decades of public service to the state of California. He is accomplished, and I got to say, he is a person of his word. He works day in and day out to improve the quality of life for Californians and our environment. We appreciate your continuing tradition of service. It is unfortunate that you are a Chicago Cubs fan, but we hope that you'll see the light for the Giants here in the months to come. And there is not a better defender of fisheries in the state and Secretary Laird, and we're really grateful that you are going to be kicking us off here today. And thank you so much, Mr. Secretary.
Thank you very much. And it's unfortunate that you mentioned the Chicago Cubs, but there is a story that involves both your districts, and that is my father, when he passed away 15 years ago, is buried in your district in Santa Rosa, and I vowed that whenever the Cubs won the pennant, I would be back. And I went to visit his grave once about 4 years ago, and I tripped over something on the way, and somebody had taken a San Francisco Chronicle that said, Giants win it all, put it in a plastic bag, and put it over somebody else's grave. So it was clear that somebody there didn't live long enough to see the Giants make it. So 2 weeks ago, in a unremarkable event, a 90-year-old guy died in Chicago, and he was the last living former Cub to have played in the World Series.
Oh, my gosh.
So we're hoping for something here.
Hey, there we go.
It's got to happen.
Yeah, exactly.
And let me thank you for continuing the tradition of this hearing. I've been the leadoff witness. I think this is the fifth time the years that I've been secretary, and I attended when I was in the legislature. I know there have been focuses on aquaculture, the shellfish initiative, marine protected areas, whole hosts of issues. Every different one has a focus, and I really appreciate the fact that you're both continuing the tradition and that you have this focus today. And it is broad when you talk about the drought and grows and fisheries, and all of that in some form falls within the Natural Resources Agency, and there are people following me that will dive into each issue very specifically. And I thought what would be good is to sort of set the context at the beginning so that it fits together in many ways. And even though I feel like you all know the drought, I feel obligated to sort of talk about it a little bit, because one of the statistics I frequently use to drive home is that 2 years ago, January, there was not a fire that CAL FIRE responded to in the state of California. A year ago, January, they responded to 473, including two significant ones in Humboldt County, which is arguably the wettest place in California during the winter. If you looked at that time in January 2014, we broke records of 1884 and 1924, of the longest consecutive days in the rainy season without rain. It had previously been 45 or 46 in Redding and Sacramento, and we went way into the 50s. Last year, for the first time in history, both the state and federal government had a 0% allocation for the 25 million Californians that depend on state and federal water and the agriculture industry. This year it's 20% state, 0% federal. And the snowpack that was measured on April 1st was 5% of normal. That was one quarter of the previous driest year in recorded history. And right now in the Sierra snowpack, it is 0% of normal, right as we speak. And so what that does is we live with all the impacts. And the impacts mix with the things that you're talking about in this hearing. And we have been trying to, we also in the agency are charged with adaptation. And if this drought goes as long as the Australian drought, we are not halfway through it yet. And so when we think of what the impacts are right now, they could only get very, very bad if it keeps going, which is the reason to take the strong responses that have been taken. There is a study out of Stanford that came out about 3 months ago, the Woods Institute and Noah Diefenbaugh, professor there, that basically tracked rainfall in California, and the driest years in history are in the last 10 or 15 years at a level that is just markedly different from what came before. And he concluded that we were moving out of a past climate into a newer climate, and that this is not about waiting for the 1 year that it rains heavily again. This is about trying to make a long-term adjustment to the fact that things just will be different in California. So we have the drought as the backdrop. And then when you look at where the developed water is in California, right now, I think there's a debate going on in California where everybody talks about the developed water in terms of what their interest is. If they're a farmer, it's like, geez, 80% goes to, of the developed water is, you know, there's 50% environmental water and 40% agriculture and 10% urban. But the interesting thing that is directly relevant to this hearing is that if you look at how the developed water in California breaks down, in a wet year, and 2006 is an example, 41% of the developed water in California went to wild and scenic rivers. An overwhelming majority of that water to wild and scenic rivers is in the North Coast rivers. In a dry year, and for measurement 2007 is used, the share that goes to wild and scenic rivers is 23%. Mm-hmm. 41% in wet, 23% in dry. So when you are looking at the rivers that might be impacted by growth or impacted by the things that people are testifying about, they're already taking a major, major hit from the drought before you even start talking about diversions. And there is an 8% in both the wet and dry years that goes for in-stream requirements, which is, you know, leans obviously heavily to fish. The drought also has this major impact on the fact that part of the whole operation of the system is to make sure that certain amount of water that's impounded is cold water and is released at certain times for the very important role it plays in the cycle of salmon and other fish. And when you have less water in reservoirs, when you have higher temperatures, you look at all these things, you have less of an ability to impound cold water. It's much more precious. And so the drought, by that very nature, challenges the ability to provide in the fish life cycle for what we have. And when you talked about the grows, there are really there are a number of impacts, but the major ones are the diverted amount of water. And if you have wild and scenic rivers, and in particular, I think the place some of these pictures apply to, I believe, is in the drainage to the eel. Mm-hmm. And the eel is already low, and you're diverting. That is a fundamental impact to fish. Additionally, there's one picture I saw that the sheriff was showing me where the ground had really been disturbed around one of the grows. And in the first months of the administration, when people were claiming a lot of different things about what was happening in the Sacramento Valley, we really ascertained that one of the toughest issues there relates to sedimentation from legacy forest roads. So when we see the sedimentation that exists there, that is a real issue with regard to fish and habitat and water quality. The sedimentation that is completely unregulated. And even though the one thing for sure besides the water board that's not in my agency is pesticides, sort of the use of pesticides and that moving in is a big issue for fish, for humans, for water quality in general. And so all those things, it's pretty hard because I think the underlying issue here is that it's pretty hard for all the rest of our regulatory schemes to truly work if there is not a regulatory scheme that is functioning well on the issue of grows. It's hard to ask everybody else to cut their water and deal with water cuts when we're not dealing with this. It's pretty hard to go to everybody that's playing by the rules on pesticides when that's not happening. and it's pretty hard to enforce the sedimentation and the grading permits that counties give and other things when we have sedimentation here that is unregulated. And I think that that's the tough question that's in front of you, is what is the appropriate response? What is doable? What can we afford to pay for? How can we do it? And that is the challenge right now. And I think shining the direct light on this is just the role of this hearing and tying together the testimony of all the witnesses that are coming. Because when you look at the actual fisheries part of it, and I'm very lucky to be followed by Chuck Bonham, our director of Fish and Wildlife, even the regulatory schemes for that, some of the fishery ones are West Coast in their entirety, where California appoints people and participates, but it is not uniquely 100% within the domain of state government. Mm-hmm. And yet the Fish and Game Commission also has a role in certain places and certain fisheries. And so I think that you're getting at the right questions and teasing out from the testimony of the people that follow all those things. It's like, if you wish to enforce, what would it take? If you wish to enforce, how would you do it? If you wish to set up a regulatory scheme, what should be in it and what can you pass? And those are big challenges, and we really stand ready to work with you on each of those. And I know that there are certain things working through the legislature. I know the administration is interested, but we recognize this is a big issue that that needs to be dealt with. And if, in fact, we are having a little bit of a shift, so historically we are going to move into drier times, then it raises the importance of dealing with this. It's one thing when it's a wetter time and things are diverted, but it's another when water is a scarce resource in California and something we have to address. With that, I'm prepared to let you get on with your hearing, and I would answer any questions you have before I have to go.
No, thank you so much, Mr. Light. I know you have a tight schedule. Do we have any questions from the members of the committee? I just wanted to say, I think that the new reality that you talk about is absolutely true. And the scarcity of resources that we've seen on the eel and the mattole this past year. In 2014, it was the first year that the eel and mattole, since written records were kept, ran dry. And it's because the drought, and there are so many illegal diversions for groves in those watersheds. I think you hit a really good point. One set of regulations for timber and ag crops, and relatively no regulation related to marijuana. And that's exactly what we're here today. So really appreciate all your service.
My pleasure.
It's good
luck
good
with your hearing.
Thank you so much, sir. Yeah. Thank you so much, Mr. Secretary. And again, we're grateful for your time. We'd like to be able to bring up Chuck Bonham. Mr. Bonham has been the director of the California Department of Fish and Wildlife since 2011, after a decade of protecting and restoring fish for Trout Unlimited. We are grateful that Mr. Bonham is here today, and in many cases, his agency is on the front lines, both on issues of drought as well as marijuana. And Mr. Bonham, we're grateful that you take time out of your busy schedule to offer some remarks.
Thank you, Senator. Let me get a little better organized. Chair, Vice Chair, Assembly members, my name is Chuck Bonham. I'm the director of the California Department of Fish and Wildlife, which I continue to think is the greatest job in the world. I remember starting in this field after spending my own money to go back to law school and understand environmental conservation law, taking law about salmon as a course, meeting Zeke Grader.
Yeah.
And I was young. I was idealistic. And darned if Zeke, who wasn't much older, was still idealistic and passionate after all his years fighting the salmon fights. So I join with you in deep appreciation for what he's done and am thankful you took the time to start this morning with an acknowledgement of him.
Oh, thank you so much, Mr. Director.
So I want to share some experiences I'm having and my staff are having, but begin by acknowledging the greatness of this state at a certain level of biodiversity, which is the measure of richness of life used in the ecological and scientific disciplines around natural resources. We have more species diversity in this state than any other state in the Union. We have the highest number of endemic species, which means those that are found nowhere else. And California is one of 25 biological hotspots on the entire globe. It's an incredible mashup of over 6,000 species, flora and fauna. We have five major climactic types. We have these pockets of incredibly rare genetic diversity across the whole state. So we lead the nation in biodiversity. Sadly, we also lead the nation in loss of biodiversity. Which brings me to my main takeaway working in this fourth year of drought. I don't think it's an dramatization to say I feel an existential crisis. Literally. So this experience has me searching for the meaning of life. Literally. It has forced most of our staff to explore their own soul, values, and priorities in this experience. And it's forced a huge amount of introspection about mortality just within our professional ranks at the department. Most staff who've committed their careers to saving things like the Amarosa vole, the San Joaquin kit fox, let alone salmon. Mm-hmm. But I don't think this existential crisis means you have to lose faith, right? In fact, it's faith that often can keep you out of depression and towards optimism in such difficult times. Maybe this whole experience is a little bit like the famous question posed in Hamlet, to be or not to be. And I think our department is choosing to be. And we find great faith in the resiliency of salmon, which I'd like to talk about at the end of my remarks. Here are some examples for us which are producing this feeling of an existential crisis. There are four key tributaries in the Russian River watershed, as you know, that may be the most high priority watersheds for preserving genetic diversity of salmon, coho principally. We at our department believe that last year we lost about 90% of our returning coho class in those tributaries. Mark West, Dutch Bill,
Filter.
Green Valley,
and
Mill Creek. At the same time, just when you think it can't get any worse, it does. A year ago, we negotiated with our federal and state agency counterparts and submitted to the State Water Board a temperature management plan for Shasta Reservoir, which is the largest federal reservoir at the top of the Sacramento system, and began to implement it. And darned if we didn't lose temperature control last year, which in our judgment resulted in about a 95% mortality rate in the 2014 brood year run of winter run salmon in the Sacramento River. So we came into this year and negotiated another temperature management plan in good faith with all those agencies and very collaborative input by reclamation districts and water users in the valley. And danged if not a couple of weeks after signing off on this year's temperature management plan, that plan was wrong because air temperatures in Redding over the last 3 months have tracked an average of almost 7 degrees warmer than expected. The incoming water from many of the tributaries into Whiskeytown Dam are about 2 degrees Fahrenheit warmer than last year. The underlying models used by the Bureau of Reclamation are not as accurate as they should be. And the whole system hinges on one temperature probe in the reservoir, which was not calibrated correctly. So as a result, we now believe that the cold water available in Shasta Reservoir is 30% smaller than we were anticipating in early May. So we face the prospect of the risk of another complete year class loss in the winter run broodstock, which would be 2 years in a row. Remember, these fish are 3-year cycle fish. At some point, you get close to an ecological tipping point. Mm-hmm. We're crunching numbers. We think there's a similar risk and impact relative to the fall run fishery, which, as you noted earlier, is the backbone of our offshore commercial fishery. But it doesn't stop there. Some advise us, use your hatcheries as your backstop. Well, damned if I now don't have whirling disease, mm-hmm. which is a protozoan parasite that destroys the cartilage of trout and salmon in our hatcheries, where it hasn't been for maybe 20 years, potentially because of drought, as the incoming tributaries to some of our hatcheries have shrunk. It's possible birds have moved into that space, picked up the parasite, and the parasite's been transported unknowingly into our hatcheries. So the very same facilities I may turn to as safe haven to pressure valve release some of our challenges in the Sacramento, in turn have their own structural challenges that we have to be careful for managing. The hydrology in the San Joaquin River system is way worse. If you take a look at the tributaries and the reservoir levels coming into the San Joaquin, than it is in the Sacramento and Shasta systems. And we have one of the most unique spring run salmon runs imaginable in Butte Creek. And we have some record-setting mortality getting close to 15 or 16% in that return of spring run salmon right now in Butte Creek. So anywhere I look, I see something that confirms this existential crisis. If you go to our pelagic species and look in the Delta, we've been running trawls for longer than I've been alive. I won't reveal how long that is, but it's over 40 years. And this fall, we recorded the lowest numbers of Delta smelt, the second lowest numbers of longfin smelt, and then this spring, we continue to record the lowest. Just to give you a frame of reference, in our spring trawl, we picked up one longfin smelt the year before we picked up 36. And I can guarantee you there's a moment ahead, maybe sooner rather than later, I'm going to have to publicly report we picked up zero. And there's none lonelier than zero in the context of population dynamics. So what are we doing about it? I think in the last 2 years, our department has in some sense dropped, and I use that phrase loosely and figuratively, many other things we should be focused on in order to turn our full energy to an all hands on deck preservation of diversity in the state at a species level. In last year's budget and the budget that starts today, you will have allocated to us in emergency funding from the general fund about $54 million. So $38 million in last budget, I think 16 in this coming. If my math right, that's 54. We're spending it across a wide variety of emergency actions. To give you some examples, we've gone to our hatchery system and we've retrofitted many of them with chillers and water filtration systems to reduce parasite spread risk, to manage many of the reservoirs which are our inflow or coming in too warm, an ability to keep our waters chilled. We just, again, evacuated all of our hatcheries on the American River. Last year and this year, we moved 30 million salmon smolts from the combined federal and state hatchery system in trucks out to the estuary because the river conditions were too lethal. Our staff have done, since January of 2014, 550 fish rescues in 40 watersheds across 22 counties, moving about 170,000 fish from pools which are too dry for them to survive into wetter spots and watersheds, or bringing them into safe haven in some of our limited hatchery space. We've spent funding from other sources. I've moved out, through our Fisheries Restoration Grant Program, specific habitat restoration programs to reduce migration barriers and improve habitat conditions, principally focused on drought. We are looking at Proposition 1 grant making at the department to be approving our first grants by the end of this calendar year, which means we'll have done that in less than 6 months of this fiscal year and within about 1 year of the voters approving Proposition 1. And we will be using as a filter anadromy as bonus points, getting grants out into anadromous waters to help fish survive this period. We remain engaged with the commercial fishing industry to barge and move these fish and test. For example, at our McCullamy and Feather River hatchery, the survivability increase by barging fish down into the Delta, tagging them, and then checking their survival rates. We've gone and closed fisheries. One of my most favorite rainbow trout personal fisheries in the world is from Highway 44 near Redding up to the city of Redding. It's about 5.5 miles. Given the dire circumstances to winter run, we closed that fishery. It's a nationally renowned trout fishery. We went out into the commercial fishery with our federal counterparts, and we talked to our commercial fishermen about taking a even more conservative impact rate restriction approach to avoid incidental harm to winter run, which meant reducing the catch opportunity for our boats in the water. And darned if our commercial fishermen and recreational anglers didn't step up and say we can live with that, because we know how dire this is. Huge kudos to them. I remain very open to some of the ideas that are produced by our counterparts in the NGO world. For example, the Golden Gate Salmon Association has raised a good idea. Is it possible to increase your production at your hatcheries in the salmon sense to deal with what might be an emerging fall run problem? Remember, most of our production is mitigation responsibility for the two major projects, state and federal, but I think there is some room for us to revisit our authority and appropriation authority related to y'all's oversight of us and put a modest amount of money on the table and help us increase our production to bridge through this period. You asked me to memorialize for you what are my priorities. At this point, I think my priorities are holding on to genetic diversity and refugia in our highest priority watersheds where there are salmon and steelhead. We can break that down geographically. We're not right now triaging the whole Russian River watershed as an example. We're looking at four places. We're not right now looking at all tributaries in the upper Sacramento. We're looking at Antelope and Deer Creek and Mill Creek. So we're doing that refugia triage, and that's our highest priority. When it comes to marijuana, we've done 100 inspections since January of 2014, and you know the water use of marijuana is about 6 to 8 gallons a day. This is probably the single biggest tip we're getting that's an incoming phone call to the department. I'd say we've probably had about 24,000 contacts, I'm generalizing, in the last year or so related to this illegal water use in the North Coast primarily. We've easily dedicated about 20,000 hours of staff time in our law enforcement division. And we've seen, and I think Scott Bauer, senior scientist for the department, will describe how dozens of watersheds which are home to coho and salmon are drying up. What I like about our approach to marijuana is that it's been grounded in your leadership on the legislative side. As y'all know, we stood up a new effort, our watershed enhancement team. It's combined with the State Water Resources Control Board. It's allowed us to approach this problem from a prioritization aspect and really analyze the greatest ecological impact from the highest number of this rogue activity in the most important watersheds for highly sensitive species. That's a key threshold filtering exercise for us. Let me end by saying, I think you survive an existential crisis by staying rooted in your values. One of the questions you put to me, Senator, was what's the future for salmon fishing in California? And I'm torn. On one hand, I've got to be open and transparent and honest and tell you, I think we're looking at a potential commercial fishery disaster kind of scenario a couple of years from now, which is not going to be fun, productive, or healthy for any of us. By the same token, these species are some of the most resilient on the planet. Their life's journeys are amazing. Secretary Bruce Babbitt used to remind us, salmon know no fixed address. They force you to look across the entire landscape. And I'm a big fan of a naturalist writer by the name of Barry Lopez. And he writes a lot about a sense of place and how one of our challenges in conservation is us losing our sense of place, and how salmon give you an incredibly sublime sense of place in an otherwise dire world. So I'm torn knowing the realistic likelihood of commercial fishing disaster and really losing some of these core populations, with also knowing deep in my heart at a faith level, I can count on these fish as incredibly resilient fighters. So I'll stop there and see if you have any questions for me.
Mr. Bonham, thank you so much. Very eloquent and absolutely sobering. You know, as you said, we're witnessing a fisheries die-off, not seen before in recent memory. And this drought is going to forever change our state's aquatic ecosystem, which is why we're here today. And I got to say, Mr. Bonham, his stress level, and I'm going to speak not for him, but just knowing his stress level is off the charts, having to be all across the state and facing multiple crises in almost every watershed, and doing it with constrained resources. So we are grateful that you're here today and would like to be able to open it up to the committee for any questions or comments. Please, Mr. Wood.
Would you mind giving us just a thumbnail? I know you're part of the watershed enforcement team that the governor's the pilot project. Would you kind of give us an idea of what you know what you're seeing on the ground, what the progress of that team has been, and what you see the future of that?
Progress, I would say, is good. Beginning with, this is my first government gig, right? And I have found that sometimes our inability across and within agencies to really synergize effort is one of our greatest Achilles heels. So a notable landmark achievement in my mind is the governor's vision and requirement that my department literally partner with the State Water Resources Control Board, but then become something more, a vehicle for our local governments. Our relationship with our law enforcement colleagues at a local level, and then also engage in active outreach and education to the potentially regulated community, the growers who otherwise want to comply with law, and go at this problem. And progress there, I think, is very notable and good. I also see progress in demonstrable facts around numbers of prosecutions, numbers of sweeps, if you will, related to dealing with the threat in these high-priority watersheds. And in a unique aspect, we're also seeing very promising partnership with tribal nations in the North Coast pursuing similar efforts in their properties under their own authorities with us. I believe I read in the paper this morning that some of the trade associations are just now announcing some of their willingness structurally on kind of a regulatory approach, and I think that's promising progress as well, that part of the industry is now coming forward with some ideas we may be able to respond to on how you would take parties through permitting to reduce natural resource impact. There will always be, as far as best I can see, more work than we have capacity for right now. That's both at an environmental scientist level, a legal level, and a law enforcement level within our own department. I'm worried about, I could rededicate everybody to this, maybe not move the needle that much more, and have lost all our capacity on all those other issues. So I'm struggling through that own topic. I do think the future of this could become what you may decide here in the legislature, and how one of the largest agricultural sectors at an income level is managed relative to natural resources damage, mitigation, and remediation. I'm also thankful that in this March emergency package, the legislature had the wisdom to approve new authorities for our department. And it was a difficult debate. We are not tossing due process. The U.S. and California constitutions still apply. The Administrative Procedures Act still applies. In fact, our department just published emergency regulations describing the due process, but we now have three new authorities around impediments to fish passage, notification to the department when you put a barrier in a waterway, and unauthorized use of water that produces damages to the natural resource coming from marijuana cultivation. I'm thankful that the agricultural community, the timber community, the Association of California Water Agencies dialogued with us in that, even though they may have had disagreements. And we're pretty insistent on following due process, but we look forward to using those authorities strategically against the greatest violators.
Thank you, Mr. Vice Chair. Thank you. Senator Member, please.
Yeah, thank you for your testimony, Mr. Bonham. And the last point was actually the one that I was most interested in. With those new, with that new authority that you have, you obviously had to do some work because you've only just recently got them. And so thank you for explaining that. Prospectively, how do you feel that these authorities will help in this circumstance?
In two main ways. We're going to give very careful attention to the details of any given case. I'm sensitive to us running off without sufficient evidence and attempting to prosecute for administrative penalties and forcing you to conclude, hey, you know, I wish I hadn't given them that authority. But I believe we will end up developing very robust administrative cases that allow us to issue administrative penalties to really the most egregious violator. The individual, hypothetically, in a watershed where the 99 other diverters who are complying with the law would tell you that person's way out of line. That's an equity and fairness benefit to the people who are taking the time to comply with the law, and it's also an ability to send a strong signal to the next person in line who may adopt an egregious practice to not do so. And our ability to issue administrative penalties, I think, will be beneficial in those two regards.
And this hasn't occurred yet? You haven't?
Not yet. We haven't pursued, but I see it on our horizon, and also being done consistent with our commitment to due process, which sets up a hearing ability, an evidentiary ability for the accused, a presumption of innocence until proven guilty, and a right of appeal, among other metrics.
Opportunity to cure the violation.
Correct.
Hopefully, too. Great. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. And I neglected to mention, want to thank our chair of the Water Parks and Wildlife in the State Assembly as well, Assemblymember Levine. So I should have mentioned that in the very beginning, and for all your efforts. I know that you've been on the front lines of this as well. I do want to welcome Senator Nielsen to the hearing. Thank you so much for being here, Senator Nielsen. Mr. Director, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Appreciate all your work, and again, really great job today.
Thank you.
All right, thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to now be welcoming Mr. Thomas Howard to the podium here. He is the Executive Director of the State Water Resources Control Board. Mr. Howard has been employed by the State Water Resources Control Board for nearly 30 years. He is here today to tell us about the decisions he faces in protecting our fisheries while balancing and meeting the needs of nearly 40 million people. Mr. Howard and his team have been working hard on the issue of the drought, and we're grateful that you're here today. Good to see you, Mr. Howard.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and Vice Chairman, and Senator Nielsen, and Assembly people. Why don't I get started by just talking for a minute about the cannabis activities that the Water Board's doing in combination with Department of Fish and Wildlife. And I see that we're probably behind schedule, so I'm going to try to be as brief as I possibly can. So we do have a joint program with Department of Fish and Wildlife. It's got four principal elements. One is the development and deployment of a regulatory program. The second is targeted enforcement, and then the last two are education, outreach, and coordination with local government. I won't get into any detail on the latter two, just to say that we really have been coordinating and discussing with this issue with just about everybody imaginable in these watersheds, all of the elected officials, sheriffs, et cetera, and been working with them on it. With respect to development of regulations, we have developed a draft permit program in the North Coast region, and I believe that that's scheduled for adoption next month in August. The Central Valley is also working on a regulatory program, and that'll probably be following in several months. But the permitting program basically would require persons engaged in cannabis cultivation to enroll in the program, comply with the terms and conditions, and pay a fee in order to support the work that's necessary for the program. And of course, the conditions are going to be things that are the management practices we feel are necessary to reasonably protect water quality. And with that, I think I'll move on to the other fish and wildlife actions by the Water Board over the last year or two. Our actions are largely guided by the Water Action Plan that was adopted a year or so ago and constitutes the collective opinions of much of the state agencies. One of the actions we're doing is what's called achieving the co-equal goals in the Delta. Basically, we're trying to update the water quality control plan for the Delta. It hasn't been effectively updated since about 95. And that'll change things like Delta outflow objectives, export objectives, Delta cross-channel gate operation, basically all of the characteristics that are necessary to protect Delta resources. We've been working on it actually for a number of years. We divided the project up into phases. This fall we'll be releasing our San Joaquin River objectives that will cover all of the San Joaquin. And we're starting to work on the Sacramento Delta side. We did receive some new resources this year from the legislature to help us expedite this activity, consistent with the Water Action Plan that has been approved. So we're looking forward to moving this forward even more quickly, but we will be seeing at least part of it coming together in this fall. The fourth action in the Water Action Plan says to protect and restore important ecosystems. And what it specifically identifies is that we, working with Department of Fish and Wildlife, are supposed to identify five watersheds and establish public trust flows for them. Again, appreciate the legislative action this year to provide resources for that to move forward. The five watersheds we're looking at are the Scott, the South Fork of the Eel, Mark West Creek, Mill Creek in the Central Valley, and the Ventura River. And so we'll be starting a process to set flow objectives on all of those. We've also been working in this drought year on temporary urgency change petitions. We've been getting a whole series of temporary urgency change petitions for ways to reoperate Central Valley reservoirs. Basically we've been trying to conserve upstream storage in order to maintain things like cold water pool and other characteristics. And so I've processed, I think, 12 orders in the last year that have basically been dealing with the operation of the Central Valley Project and the State Water Project. And I've adopted about 37 other temporary urgency change petitions around the state, most of them with the idea that we're going to conserve water for both human consumption and to ensure that there's adequate flows, that the streams don't go dry at various locations. Shasta temperature is obviously a big issue. That's part of a temporary urgency change petition. There's a long history here with Shasta temperature. It started in 1990 when the board adopted an order requiring the Bureau to put a temperature control device on Shasta. It also established a temperature task force that meets annually to figure out where to comply with the 56 degree temperature requirement needed to protect the winter run Chinook salmon. And by the way, this is all for the benefit, or principally for the benefit of winter run, which are able to spawn only beneath Shasta Dam. This process has been sort of ticking along, and people haven't really noticed it because there's been enough cold water over the years. But last year, they went through the normal process. They approved a plan. But come early September, they ran out of cold water, which was not the way it had been modeled. Temperatures rose. There was a lot of mortality. This year, as you've heard, we had, we went through the usual process. I approved a plan. 2 weeks later, I was told by the Bureau that they couldn't actually meet that plan, so I then disapproved it. Over the last several weeks, we've been working on a new plan, which changes the outflows out of Shasta. And instead of the 56 degrees, we've set the target at 57, which is, questionable, but it was basically impossible to meet the 56 degree target. So, and because Shasta is sort of the crux of the Central Valley, this has cascading effects throughout both the Sacramento Basin, the exchange contractors, the Upper Delta Mendota Canal, the Friant contractors. It has effects on Folsom Reservoir and its operation, on Oroville Reservoir and its operation. And so this whole system for this year is sort of balanced on a knife edge. It looks like it'll work. But like I say, it's a knife's edge, and it's a pretty uncomfortable position to be in. Other things we've done, we have authority to adopt emergency regulations to protect fish. Chuck briefly mentioned that in the Sacramento Valley, we adopted emergency regulations to curtail diversions on Mill Deer and Antelope Creek. Those are where the last wild spawning naturally spawning populations of spring run are. The issue here is that you've got some large diversions right near where these creeks enter Sacramento River, and so you needed passage flows to get the fish past those dams and up into the upper watershed where there was good quality habitat. So, unfortunately, we were in the position of having to cease diversion or order diversions to cease for some of the people who'd been operating under water rights since the 1870s in those watersheds. You've also briefly heard Chuck mention about Mill, Marquess Creek, Green Valley, Mill, and Dutchbill Creeks in the Russian River watershed. We adopted emergency regulations last month that had two characteristics. One, we are asking for information for all people taking water in the watershed. That is both surface water and groundwater diversions. We have not in the past really called much on groundwater diversions. But in this particular case, in these areas, we believe it's the groundwater diversions that are actually the problem, that the surface water diversions are relatively limited. So we have the information order, and then we also did a conservation order for the non-agricultural parties. We also have a draft order that we have prepared, but which we haven't brought forward, that would do curtailments in those watersheds as well, both for surface water and groundwater diverters. I don't know if we're going to move forward with that, but that's certainly an option there. And the last thing I think I'd mention is we've been doing curtailments of water diversions based on the water right priority system. We've curtailed about 9,218 diversions. We have a bunch of inspectors out right now looking make sure that these diversions have actually been curtailed. Lessons learned from 30 years working in water rights and the water board. I'll briefly mention curtailments. It doesn't work very well. The water board is not in a position to really try to real-time manage water rights. That's really meant to be through an adjudicatory process, an adjudication of the watershed, and these watersheds have not been adjudicated, and so we're sort of acting like pseudo-adjudications. But because people have not been adjudicated, and they often think they have rights that are quite different than what they actually are, us acting through curtailments is just generating lots and lots of litigation. We say there's no water available for your appropriation, and they say, oh yeah, and we're all off to court. The second thing I'd point out is you know, fundamentally, we have a water rights system that is not functioning appropriately, and you know, and it's not any secret. It's very simple how a well-functioning water rights system would work. It would have four elements. You would set public trust flows in streams that had values that you needed. You would adjudicate that stream so that the parties who wanted to divert in that watershed would know where they stood with respect to everyone else and what they had to do when it got dry. You would have a water master of some kind who would enforce that adjudication, and you would measure everything. You'd measure the diversions, you'd measure stream flows so that you'd be able to actually know when to pull the trigger on various curtailments and whatnot. So how many streams in the north part of the state have something like that? And the answer is none. How long would it do if the water board's being asked to do that with what we have available to us? A couple of centuries. So, you know, what's happening now, like in what's happening in Marquess Creek and in other creeks where basically perennial streams are now becoming ephemeral streams, is sort of the inevitable consequence of this lack of management of the water rights system. And it's going to not only continue, it's going to get worse throughout the state over time, unless the, you know, a system that actually functions is put into place. And that, those are my comments. Thank you.
No, thank you so much. Greatly appreciate those words, and again, dedicating your career to the state. I have some specific questions, but I wanted to open it up to the committee, and we'll go to Senator Nielsen, and it's really good to see you, sir.
Tom or Mr. Howard, thank you very much. You know, your 30 years show in your presentations before the board and obviously here. And we're certainly well aware, and thank you for acknowledging the Shasta issue and the temperature factors and the complexities. It's rather interesting for me to be put in the position of dealing with Shasta from the representative of Shasta for so many years and now part of Sacramento that is indeed affected. I think the message in that is there are many affected parties, including urban, agricultural, domestic. It's all of the above. And I do appreciate the delicate balance and the balance of water rights. And being a part of the 109 or the 2009 negotiations and the co-equal goals, there were considerations that humans had water rights too. Isn't that correct?
Oh, absolutely.
And that's part of the balancing act.
Sure.
For a long time, I had argued that we in our water policy had become delta-centric and, I guess, if you will, fish-centric. And I did something in the 80s called SB 1086, a management plan for the Sacramento River, and that has generally worked, at least according to Zeke Grader, who I enormously respect. But we're far from where we're at. Let's get back to the instant situation. One I did want to mention, in terms of the marijuana, you're doing some enforcement now, and I was participating with a number of our sheriffs over the last 3 years, actually, and one of the concerns was providing security for your personnel. Are you satisfied, the board, that your personnel are now through the protocols, working with local law enforcement, sufficiently protected to go do what they have to do?
Yes.
Okay. And the enforcement actions on these individuals, that's fines, or are there some actually criminal penalties that you're...
So we've done, I think, since over the last 9 months, we've done about 87 inspections. We've only actually issued one fine for $300,000, but we have issued five cleanup and abatement orders where we told people to actually clean up the mess that they made, which might end up costing more than a fine would. And then we've also issued a number of minor, what we call notices of violation to parties. Now, you know, I would point out that while there's a lot of, it's a hopeful process, and having regulations is a good idea. You know, there are tens of thousands of these operations, and, you know, we've been able to visit 87 of them in basically a year's time. So, you know, we have to get a regulatory program in place that actually functions, because we're not going to be able to do inspections for all of these.
Indeed, I see that, and I look forward to working with you on it. There are a number of factors extant out there, including the cameras that are helpful in terms of identifying the fire hazards. And they could be a useful purpose in identifying some illegal activities in those forests as well. Most important for right now, the water rights. You said about 200 years, and I guess that's probably an optimistic projection to sort all of this out. It is very important, the pre-1914 particularly, and the senior water rights for sure, and the area of origin water rights, which were further affirmed in the statutes in 2009's water plan, and in fact the water bond Prop 2. But we don't have the luxury of 200 years worth of dealing. How does the board weigh the pre-14 and senior water rights vis-a-vis the considerations for our fish? How do you balance that?
Well, the consideration comes when you actually try to decide what it is you're going to adopt as a fish objective, because when you do the modeling, you can see what the consequences of that decision are to the water right holders. And so at that point, you have to look at the economics, the groundwater impacts, the fish impacts, and try to balance all of the the demands on the water system and in the watershed, and reach a decision that is considered balanced. Once that decision is made, then theoretically you would enforce it, and you would enforce it by doing curtailments of parties who were, if there wasn't water available for them, and maybe in the very driest times that would push you down into very senior water right holders. But like I say, it's the actual development of the standards that's where that balancing occurs.
And in the balancing, you're now going to 57 degrees. I guess that just is an artful compromise to do the best you can and monitor to see if that's helpful, correct?
There's some information that says that 57 should be sufficient. It's, right on the, obviously, on the ragged edge. And the truth was that with the terrible shape of the cold water pool in Shasta, that we couldn't meet 56. We would be in the same situation we were in last year, where we would be able to meet 56 for a few months, but then the last month or so go out of control, and it would be a waste of time to be, working with doing this all through the season anyway.
Well, I don't want to dominate. I thank you so much, Tom. You're certainly the expert here. I will just rhetorically observe that what we're talking about here is another argument for the Prop 2 provisions for surface storage, sites, reservoir, and temperance flat. Now, that's carrying on its own right, and the Water Commission would make determinations related there, too. But that was something that the voters clearly supported, and it would be something that would be helpful to fish and human and agriculture altogether. But, Tom, thank you for your usual great wisdom.
I had a couple of minor comments that I'd like to follow up on. One is this issue of 200 years. I mean, that's probably optimistic. But that was under the assumption that it's the State Water Board with its existing resources and its existing model is the way to do that. I would not suggest that as the way to actually achieve the kind of water right system I was referring to. I really think that a more likely model would be one along the lines of the groundwater legislation that was adopted, where local parties would be responsible for developing the public trust flows and the adjudication, and then it would perhaps come to the water board for adoption. The other thing I'd like to mention is I keep hearing people talk about illegal marijuana diversions. The vast majority of those diversions are legal. They're riparian in nature. They can, as long as it's a direct diversion, they have, as property owners adjacent to the stream, a riparian right to divert. However, I see over here where they've developed ponds, and the funny thing is while you can directly divert riparian water, you can't put it into a pond. So the pond water, diverting water into a pond, is illegal. Direct diversions would be, assuming that they are riparian, which they often are, would be legal.
That is that they have title to the land, though, correct?
Or they're legally, renting it.
Yeah, and that's of issue because a lot of them are poachers, too. Yeah. But you balance all that, and you find out when you investigate.
I think the challenge is that the state simply does not know how many diverters there are, and when you have this historic drought, it only compounds the situation. So we'll have some comments on that. But Mr. Vice Chair, thank you so much, Mr. Nielsen.
Not encouraged by the prospect of waiting for 200 years to have some of these things resolve. As someone from the city of Healdsburg, where we've been waiting for a simple change on a water issue for 18 years, pretty discouraged by that. Would obviously love to see the resources available to help move some of these things along. And appreciate the perspective on how the board looks at the diversions related to marijuana. I guess in my mind, in the end, the diversion itself may be legal in some rights, but the end result is an illegal activity in storage and ponds that simply do not belong for a lot of reasons. So appreciate that clarification and thank you for being here.
Thank you.
I think the take issue as well, you see the impacts of those fish.
Yes, absolutely.
I just have a couple, Mr. Vice Chair, anything else? Thank you so much, Mr. Wood. Just a couple of items. Real quick, give us your perspective. Your time at the board, have you seen another time like we're witnessing now in this drought as far as the severity of the challenges that this faces related to water?
No, the last time we had anything close to this was 1977, and I wasn't there in 1977, but I believe we're in a worse situation, substantially worse situation now than then. This is quite extraordinary, and it's been also a chance for the Water Board to actually, you know, try to move some issues forward. So, you know, it's not that that's a good story, but in answer to your question, no, it is an extraordinary time.
The other question I have is that where Mr. Bonham was discussing related to 30% less Shasta related to cold water storage, the options are running thin, and just trying to be able to come up with a solution with what we have, but we're running out of options at the moment. Related to, so for example, Shasta, having 30% less cold water storage,
sure.
We're in a bit of a pickle.
Yeah, well, that's why the plan ended up for Shasta temperature operation ended up getting changed.
Yeah.
The outflows were dropped from the expected outflows this month were 8,500, and we dropped them to 7,250 CFS. And that has consequences all down the system. So we, at least right now, the best information we have is that we'll be able to maintain temperature control at 57 degrees at the compliance point of Clear Creek through the season of spawning and rearing in at least that small section of right below Shasta.
If you can give us some perspective, as we are seeing major crisis related to fisheries this season. If you can give us perspective, if we saw a similar winter as we saw in 2014, what can Californians expect with the amount of storage we'll have after this fall?
Well, these things are cumulative. Each year, the carryover storage is generally a little lower, and so each year, and you come into the season, the diversion irrigation season, with less water in storage. Some reservoirs like Folsom, which are relatively large small reservoirs for a large watershed, are not usually all that affected. But reservoirs like New Melones, which is a large reservoir for a small watershed, very much affected by the carryover storage amount. And Shasta as well would be potentially, coming into. But, this year we're going to end up at the end of the year in Shasta with about the same about the same carryover storage we had last year. So, we, at these lower release rates, have a somewhat sustainable system there. But, fundamentally, your question is this going to get worse? And the answer is, well, yes, it is, because really these drought is an accumulative thing, and each year will, as it stays dry, will become worse.
I'd like to address, and this is my final question, related to the four tributaries of the Russian. I think that majority of landowners want to be able to comply knowing that it is a crisis that we face. Ensuring, though, that their data is going to remain confidential has been an item that I know, I'm sure Senator Wood has heard, I know we've heard as well, and wanting those assurances from the state of when they do turn over that information to the state on how to be able to keep that data confidential. And the way we've done it, and I see representatives here from the Sonoma County Water Agency when it comes to our groundwater basin plan, is working with a nonprofit where that data would be sent. Can you talk about that a bit? Because there is some concern related to the confidentiality of that data once it goes to the board.
Yeah, and, you know, I honestly am going to have to get back to the committee on that question because I'm not a lawyer. But as a general rule, the water board's data, if it solicits data in a regulatory setting, that data is public. But, you know, we do have some confidentiality provisions for, you know, business secrets and that sort of thing. So I'll check and get back to the committee very quickly as to how exactly we intend to treat this data.
That would be great. I did ask Mr. Bonham that a couple weeks back. And again, the way we've been able to work that, and I see Ann here, and who's very familiar with it, is working with an RCD. So that it goes to the Resource Conservation District versus the public agency. Mm-hmm. So, and significant compliance turning over in our groundwater management plan from dairies to vineyard owners to residents. And I just wanted to ensure that the data is going to be confidential.
Like I said, I will certainly check on them.
Yeah, please.
Mr. Chairman, on that point, and I would like to underscore your concern, it's a manifest concern to me, and the bigger problem with this confidentiality is the state legislature and the groundwater legislation that passed last year and that is in process this year. And keep in mind that this bill or bills this year are going to be treated as trailer bills, and they're going to be done in the dark of night, and they're probably, in fact, I think there'll certainly not be policy committee hearings. And these are going to be requiring a lot of access to well logs, individual well logs, that's going to affect a lot of people that we represent and a lot of communities. So it's our job as legislators to be wary of those factors, that what the legislature additionally adds in terms of making that public information.
Yeah, and I think that's something that we're going to need to be able to work through. Again, I know that what we've heard at least along the North Coast is that folks want to be able to comply, but the concern is just making sure, as Senator Nielsen, you just articulated. So thank you so much, Mr.
Sure,
Secretary.
Thank
you. Great to see you. Thank you. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to be moving on to our second panel, where we are going to be hearing about drought impacts and the commercial and recreational fishing industries. We are going to bring forward John McManus. He's the executive director of the Golden Gate Salmon Association. We also have Tim Sloan, who's here today, and welcome, Mr. Sloan, good to see you again, who's director of programs for the Pacific Coast Federation of Fishermen's Association. Mr. McManus is going to be giving us an update from the Golden Gate Salmon Association, and then Mr. Sloan will be following up. We have until about 11:45 for this panel. Please don't take me giving you time prompts as me being rude, but just wanting to ensure that we're able to hit all of our panelists. And we're grateful to both Mr. Sloan and Mr. McManus, who's able to attend today. We'll turn it over to John here to kick us off. And we have a PowerPoint right behind my noggin, and I'm going to switch seats.
Morning, folks. Senator McGuire, members. I'm John McManus. I'm the executive director of the Golden Gate Salmon Association. We're a coalition representing both sport and commercial salmon fishermen and related businesses. We also work closely with allied conservation groups. I want to thank you for your interest and support for salmon. We've heard some very interesting speakers this morning, and congratulations for bringing them on and getting some information out. I'd like to give you credit for the U.S. women's victory last night, but I'm in the wrong room for that probably. Wanted to thank you for your support of a bill that moved earlier that had to do with increased funding of hatchery fish. It passed both budget subcommittees in the Assembly and the Senate, but was ultimately pulled after the California Department of Fish and Wildlife offered another path forward, and we're cautiously optimistic about that moving forward. We're very appreciative of the good work being done for coastal salmon, especially salmon on the Eel River and the Klamath River, which in some years contribute quite a bit to our ocean salmon fishery. But our bread and butter mostly comes from the Sacramento Valley, of which we've been hearing quite a bit this morning. Sacramento Valley provides most of the salmon caught along the California and the Oregon coasts. This fish that you're seeing is a picture shot in Newport, Oregon. It's three-quarters of the way up the Oregon coast, and the chances are that's California Sacramento Valley salmon. I want to actually shift to the issue that you've heard quite a bit about earlier today, and it's what happened to our salmon runs in 2014. And in 2014, a generation of salmon was lost. Hot water killed the eggs. That's basically what happened. The eggs failed to hatch. Quite a bit's been made about the loss of the winter run. We depend on the fall run to supply the commercial and the sport fishery, and there has been no official documentation about the loss of the fall run last year, but our information suggests it was as bad or worse as what happened to the winter run. This graphic here shows you basically the fall run down on the very bottom, that little dinky purple pinkish line on the bottom that shows you about 3.5 million fry were counted at Red Bluff. This came from 195 million eggs that were laid in the upper Sacramento Basin last year. Of that, we got about 3.5 million fry. This is a back of the napkin estimate. It looks like that's about 2%, which suggests that we lost about 98% of the fall run. One of the things that we would like to ask is that this committee, if it can, use its influence to get this documented. This is our estimation. It would be great to get official numbers from either the National Marine Fisheries Service, California Department of Fish and Wildlife, or both. And of the fish that hatched, this is what we're seeing. This is a dried up creek. This is in the upper Sacramento watershed. And people here know this is going on all over California, not only in the Central Valley, but obviously out on the coast as well. We've heard from both Director Bonham and Tom Howard about the possibility that we could see a repeat in 2015 of what happened in 2014, and we're very much worried about it. You heard Tom Howard just tell us that they're aiming for 57 degrees. The 56 degree number comes out of the federal biological opinion, and it's not ideal. 55 is even better if you want to talk about hatching salmon eggs and having the water cold enough. 57, the documentation shows we're already starting to lose salmon at 57 degrees. And we've been told by the agencies that if the weather gets too hot in Redding, we get a bunch of 110 degree days up there, we could be moving up above 57 degrees. There's been discussion, brief mention of the hatchery fish. This is a shot showing some of the fish that were trucked down to the San Francisco Bay and released. That's an acclimation net pen that they're put in. They get out of the tanker trucks and they're all goofy. Takes them about 15 to 30 minutes to get their wits about them. When they're first dumped out, they're swimming upside down and on the surface. Within 30 minutes, they're down on the bottom. They're schooling up. They're acting like fish ought to. And then they can be towed out on an outgoing tide and released. So we get much, much higher survival when we truck these fish, especially in drought years where the conditions in the river are not conducive to out-migration. We believe this is an answer, and it has been done the last 2 years. Because of that, we're hopeful that over the next few years, we know we're going to see a dip in the return of natural fall run fish. And we're hoping that we may have enough hatchery fish that we can still continue to have a fishery responsibly managed. Not sure. I heard Director Bonham this morning warn about possible catastrophe to the commercial fishery in the coming years, which was new and different and very worrisome. Just a slide to illustrate, the loss of salmon is hurting not only the coastal communities, but the inland communities. On the left, it's a shot of commercially harvested coast fish being processed. On the right, it's a shot of people fishing for salmon in the upper Sacramento River. A lot of those boats are guided boats, where people are paying $200 a head to be in those boats. You can imagine the economic boost salmon bring to the upper community. And I want to say that there's a lot of residents in the Sacramento Valley that also rely on salmon to help feed the family, just as there are on the coast. I've been up in the Upper Valley, and it's kind of embarrassed to say, but I've tried to find Starbucks and had a really hard time because not everybody wants to spend $2 on a cup of coffee, and not everybody can. And yet, during salmon season, you see huge amounts of people down on the banks trying to take something home for the dinner table. So I just want to make the point that these fish are really important to a lot of different groups. You heard Tom Howard just talk about 7,250 cubic feet per second, which is currently coming out of Shasta and Keswick Dam. This is the small regulatory dam that's just a couple miles downstream from Shasta. I want to make the point that that 7,250 number is not the ideal number for salmon. I've been told by people who know that if the releases were only for salmon, they would be lower right now. They'd be closer to 6,000. And that the 7,250 is an attempt to balance not only the needs of salmon right now, but also other users. So we've heard a lot of voices call for increased flows, especially in July. I just want to flag that 7,250 is already a compromise. And to the extent this committee can support the State Water Board in holding these flows at 7,250, it would be very much appreciated by the salmon community. There's also been quite a bit of information that water is being wasted, it's being allowed to flow out to the ocean. I just want to take a second to address that. This slide actually comes from state sources. And that little dinky, tiny blue slice showing 2% is basically what was released for fisheries. 2%, and this is 2015. That's a state source. We got that slide from the Water Board. Put that at rest. And I want to shift gears just for a second. Hopefully we won't have drought forever. Hopefully it'll rain again and we'll get some salmon production back. We have a rebuilding plan we've spoken to some of you about, and I just want to briefly hit on a couple of elements of that rebuilding plan that hopefully we can get to one of these days when drought's behind us. One of the things that we're looking at is fixing the Feather River. This slide here shows you Lake Oroville, which the Feather River flows into as a giant dam. Water's released, it comes down. And what you see is both the natural Feather River stream bed, plus this thing over on the left hand with the right angle, which is called the Thermalito After Bay, which is an artificial man-made pond where quite a bit of the Feather River is diverted into. It's very shallow. And the reason it's there is to warm water so it can be delivered to rice farmers at a warmer temperature, which helps the rice grow. All fine and good. Only problem is quite a bit of that water continues to rejoin the Feather River after it's warmed. And the next 15 miles to 20 miles of Feather River going downstream, which isn't shown in this map, is basically too hot to support salmon spawning. There's pretty easy fixes which have been contemplated and studied. By the way, when they built Oroville Dam, they didn't bother to put a fish ladder on it. And to add insult to injury, they put this water heater in and now run this water through it. We have ways we can bypass the water heater. We can get the water back into the lower Feather River at a colder temperature. We could bring the Feather River back online as a major salmon producer. And in good years, it's a really big salmon producer. So we will be talking to you in the future about that and looking for your help on this.
I don't mean to be pushy. I just want to aware of time and making sure that we also have Mr. Sloan. I think you're going to be saying a few words as well.
Sure. So, okay. Let me get to the end. This might look familiar. You're looking at the town we're sitting in right now, coming in off Highway 80. You drive over the Yolo Bypass, and what happens is water drains down the Yolo Bypass. It's a flood control device, and sometimes salmon swim up the flood control canals and get stuck. This shot was taken last December with adult salmon stuck in the ag canals. We've also been talking about trying to fix this. This is a picture of the Fremont Weir, where when water is flowing down in flood stage from the upper sac, it purposely is allowed to flow into the Yellow Bypass, connecting where those fish get stranded. And this point here is pretty easy. There's proposals on the blackboard. I just want to flag your attention. It's another easy thing we can do for salmon. Finally, we're seeking permits to restore areas in the upper sac, although this is actually a shot of the American River, but it shows you a good before and after shot. The before is on the left. Notice what looks like an island. It has old stream beds. It used to be rearing grounds that were dried out. On the left, they went in with bulldozers. They reopened those channels, and now you got good rearing grounds for salmon. We've got a bunch of projects on the upper Sacramento that would do the same thing. Instead of getting skinny, starving, baby salmon that come down these rivers, you put these channels back in, you get big, fat, robust, healthy salmon. Oh, one more point. In the last Great Recession, CDFW's budget was slashed, and it's never been restored. We take this opportunity to encourage this body, if you can, to restore the funding to CDFW that everybody needs. This is a shot of a whole bunch of those CDFW guys in dry suits rescuing some of those fish last December with a gaggle of press gathered round. This is a shot of a CDFW personnel in the upper Sacramento River measuring salmon nests that are being dewatered. We don't have nearly enough of these guys. We need more budget. We need more of these guys in the upper river, and I will stop there.
And I know the committee is going to have some questions. We'll let Mr. Sloan make his presentation, then we'll come back and ask questions of both. Really nice job. Thank you so much, Mr. Sloan.
Chairman McGuire, members of the committee, thanks for allowing me the opportunity to speak today. My name is Tim Sloan. I'm the incoming executive director of the Pacific Coast Federation of Fishermen's Associations. We're the largest organization of commercial fishing men and women on the West Coast. And my members rely on the Chinook salmon that rear in the Sacramento, San Joaquin, and Klamath Rivers to put food on their tables and to pay for their kids' college tuitions. I'm honored and humbled to be here testifying for you in place of my predecessor and mentor, Zeke Grader. Thank you very much for the kind words earlier today. Most of you know or have interacted with Zeke over the years, and you know that he's a stalwart advocate for fishing families. And his tactics have always been simple, and those are to speak plainly and to never make a deal that's bad for the fish. And I also wanted to assure Director Bonham that Zeke remains idealistic about the opportunity to rebuild salmon to their former glory in California. Zeke's dealing with some pretty serious health issues at this time, but if he were here, the issue that would be screaming for his attention is that we're looking down the barrel of another complete closure of the ocean salmon fishery. This could occur as early as next year when the 2013 brood year fish start to make the run back up to their natal streams. These fish are the first year class of fish who have lived their entire lives during this drought specifically. And on top of that, we're most certainly going to have restrictions due to concerns over impacts on the winter run. In 2008, 2009, the salmon season in California and Oregon shut down completely. It was a loss of a $1.4 billion industry. Thousands of people were out of jobs. There was a loss of a psychic connection to the ocean that a lot of these fishermen weren't able to enjoy those years. We went after the federal government for disaster relief money those years, and we got it, thankfully. That money is going to be significantly harder to come by this year with this Congress. And so be forewarned. We're going to be coming to you guys and asking you for disaster relief funds in the event of this sort of catastrophe. Now, it's difficult to comprehend why we would be needing to set you guys up for a request for disaster relief when we know that California's salmon industry, if it were healthy, it would be worth about $6 billion and support 94,000 jobs. So make no mistake that it's not the drought alone that's killing the salmon industry. And I think that the situation that we've been talking about on the upper Sac is illustrative of the water decision-making that is killing both the species and this industry. You guys all know about this situation, so I wanted to hit a few key points for my constituency. We wanted to exhort you to assert your influence over DWR, the State Board, Bureau of Reclamation, CDFW, to fix the temperature model that has caused these calamities up on the upper Sac. I mean, we know that this thing is broken. We knew in 2014 that, or after 2014, we learned that that model was off by at least a degree, and that's essential for salmon. That one degree is everything. And that model needs to get fixed. We'd also like to support Mr. McManus's request for an accounting of what happened to the fall run in 2014, an official accounting, that is. We think that the agencies who are responsible for doing that modeling need to be using the most extreme variables during these times of crisis, during these times of drought crisis. Modeling on the hottest 50% of ambient air temperatures isn't going to cut it when we have three-month forecasts that are showing it's going to be the hottest year on record. And it's 114 degrees in Redding today. Mm-hmm. You know, that's going to kill fish. We find it curious that the Bureau had information that their temperature analysis was wrong, and yet at their May 20th hearing, they presented that temperature plan to the State Board and didn't make any mention of problems with temperature modeling. Please do everything in your power to require agencies to tell the whole truth when reporting information to information about California's most critical natural resource. It's pretty clear that the 57-degree temperature plan and 7250 CFS is going to kill fish. The hatchery fish that are released into warm water conditions are not going to cut it to supplement the natural spawners, and they too are at risk when the temperatures exceed 56 degrees. As John pointed out, the current plan actually represents a compromise between the needs of fish and the needs of agriculture, and we ask that you resist any demands to backslide on fish protections under the current plan. What this all comes down to is accountability. We need to ensure that our state and federal fish and water managers are accountable for the decisions they make and the impacts they have on fish and fishermen. We're not seeing the Bureau or DWR or even CDFW and NIMS being held to the standards that the law requires. 57 degrees is an example of that. They're required to protect those fish, and yet they've repeatedly shown that they're having incredible difficulties in doing so. The way things are going, the blood of the Central Valley Chinook are eventually going to be on someone's hands. And make no mistake, the loss of these fish would not be happening but for human intervention in their life histories. And as the Chinook go, so goes the fishing fleet. So I hope that when the time comes, you and the agencies and the governor can all say that you did everything in your power to prevent that from happening. I wanted to briefly touch on marijuana, if I might have that chance. It's another issue of accountability. We have agricultural operators who are growing an agricultural product who are not regulated under the rest of the laws of this state. We think you need to bring them into the light. We think that illegal water diversions are probably and should be public enemy number one during this drought, and that you need to do whatever you can to up the penalties, to make them fast-tracked. Make sure that these guys are brought into the light and that diversions stop, illegal diversions, that is. Other than that, I think I'm done with my remarks. Thank you.
No, thank you so much, both of you, and I greatly appreciate the two of you and the time that you spent in the presentations and being here today. We'd like to be able to turn it over to the committee and see if there's any questions.
Just a comment, you know, and that we hear you loud and clear, these are issues that going forward that I believe that Senator McGuire and I will continue to focus on. It isn't just the drought; it's a lot of other issues. So it's really important that we heard this from you today, and that you know that we'll continue to be engaged on these issues as well as the marijuana and watershed restoration and so forth. So thank you very much for your presentation.
One more brief addendum. We asked for an accounting of 2014 fall run.
Yes.
I'd also like to flag, it could be very useful to get an accounting of what happens in 2015.
Okay.
We think we're going to lose fish. If we don't, that's great. That's better if we don't. But no matter what, it would still be useful, I think, to everybody to get a good accounting of what type of egg to fry survival we get on both the winter run and the fall run.
Okay. Great. Thank you.
No, thank you very much. I have four follow-up items so far from the hearing. Is that the 2014, and I just heard we'll work on the 15 accounting. Two is the confidentiality issue with the Water Board. Three is the discussion about the out-migration strategy and ensuring that it is able to continue. And then four is the temperature model in the upper SAC and the continued concern related to those high temps. I do have a question. Is that one of the items that the director from Fish and Wildlife brought up is the whirling disease and the hatchery stock. Can you comment on that, your thoughts, particularly as it would impact the industry?
The director didn't actually tell us which hatcheries that afflicts, and I think that may be relevant here. I think we may be talking about either Nimbus or the Feather River. Tom, do you know offhand? But I don't think we're talking about Coleman, and I don't think we're talking about the McCollumy.
Yeah.
Coleman, these hatcheries are not all the same size in terms of what they produce. Coleman, which is up near Reading, is the gigantic one, which gives us 12.5 million smolts annually. By comparison, Feather River is about 8 million, 10 million, and 8 million. Nimbus, I want to say, is 4 million. McCollumy is something like 4 to 6. So McCollumy, as I understand, it's in good shape. Coleman, as I understand, it's in good shape. So I don't really know what that's going to mean.
All right, well, we're in fact trout hatcheries.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much. Anything else, Jim? Again,
thank
really
you.
Nice job today. Thank you so much. Really grateful. Great job. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are continuing to move and would like to be able to bring up our next panel. This will be our last panel of the day, and we've dedicated the most time to this panel as well. And that's related to the impacts of marijuana grows on fisheries. We have a diverse group of individuals. We're going to call up our first three, and then we'll have our final two just because of chair space is the only reason why we're doing that. I would like to be able to bring forward Dwayne Little, who is lieutenant from the California Department of Fish and Wildlife. And Lieutenant Little is going to be talking about the impacts of fish and wildlife as seen on the ground, particularly when it comes to the environmental degradation. We'd like to be able to bring up Scott Grayson, who's the executive director of Friends of the Eel River. The Eel River has seen some of the most significant impact related to rogue grows within the watershed. And we're also going to be calling up Tom Allman, sheriff from Mendocino County, who will be talking about the impacts that he's seen from his department, particularly on the environmental side. And I do know that Mr. Allman will also be discussing some impacts in the community. We'll then have Lawrence Dwight come up. He's representing the California Cattlemen's Association, a rancher on the North Coast. And we're grateful that Hezekiah Allen will be coming up after we are able to free up the seats. He is the executive director of the Emerald Growers Association, and will be also providing the perspective from the association. We're going to kick it off, though, with Mr. Little and Mr. Lieutenant. We're grateful that you're here today, and I just want to put in a quick plug and say thank you to Mr. Bauer. He's just been fantastic, and we're grateful to be working with him as well. And Mr. Little, we're just so happy that you're here to be able to give us an update about marijuana and what you're seeing through the department.
Thank you.
I want to make sure. There you go. You got your mic on. There we go. Great.
It's a privilege to be here, and Mr. Bauer extends his regret in not being here.
No, we're grateful you're here. I just wanted to say to you just how grateful we are for all of his work.
Okay.
So thank you so much.
Thank you. A couple years ago, I was thrust in a position of consulting the Water Board and having the privilege of giving them some technical advice about how we should pursue this this venture and this joint venture with the Water Board. Little did I know that it would spearhead into a position of leading a team of biologists and game wardens that jointly investigate cannabis cultivation and its impacts on the environment. So I'm here to basically discuss the environmental impacts associated with the compassionate use act and the infrastructure that was developed as a result of that, and how that necessarily impacts our resources, primarily our fisheries resources. As you all know, the Emerald Triangle is the focal point of cannabis cultivation in North America. Humboldt County Sheriff's Office estimates that in Humboldt County alone, approximately 4,000 plants, 4,000 grows are located there, and that's a conservative estimate. Industry standards state, cannabis industry standards state that there's possibly 50,000 grows alone in California. We've seen over the last 5 to 10 years a steady progression of cannabis cultivation in the Central Valley, primarily Humboldt. Shasta and Tehama County. A lot of that is also attributed to the fact that the cartel or the drug trafficking organizations have seen increased pressure in the national forest and also have taken advantage of moving into the valley floor and acting under the guise of 215. Many of you have probably seen this image of Post Mountain, the poster child of high-density cannabis cultivation and its impacts on the resource. You can see the habitat fragmentation that's occurring here. We see this a lot throughout the Northern California, primarily in large tracts of private land clustered together. And it has, a lot of times, it's focused around critical habitat for samanids. This is happening in West Shasta County, East Shasta County, southwestern Tehama County, in addition to Post Mountain, the Garberville area, and so forth. Here, for instance, is the Post Mountain area, Basin Gulch, which is a tributary to Rattlesnake Creek. It is, historically, there's a lot of logging going on, a lot of logging roads put in place. This is approximately 2005, an aerial image. And here we have 2012, another aerial image, and you can see the habitat fragmentation occurring as a result of the 215 style grows. I flew this area 2 weeks ago, and there literally is very little canopy in between a lot of these grows in some of this area. In some areas, it's distinguished by a single line of trees. That's how dense it's become. So what are the natural resource impacts associated with cannabis cultivation? First and primary, we have water diversions during low flow periods, and we have issues associated with no screening and oversized pumps. We're seeing streams drained at an alarming rate. One of the main issues also is pollution, sediment being that primary source associated with 215 or style grows. We also have fertilizers, pesticides being a primary issue. A lot of these grows, we have no BMPs in place, no best management practices. So there's no setbacks from riparian corridors for protection. And we have, as I mentioned already, we have conversion and fragmentation of large tracts of land. One of the primary issues that we're trying to protect are our sensitive fish and amphibian species. We have the southern torrent salamander, the coastal tail frog. These species are found in the headwaters of a lot of our coastal streams. Their populations are very limited. They acquire cool, well-oxygenated water, and they are very vulnerable to a lot of the dewatering that's going on in these headwater streams. Also of concern are our coho, steelhead, chinook, and coastal cutthroat. So what did we see in 2014? What brought us to this point? In July of 2014, for instance, we had Sproul Creek outside of west of Garberville. Sproul Creek in July of 2014 was running at record level lows. In August of 2014, it was dry. Here we have the Eel River at Fort Seward, east of Garberville, and we can show that the mean daily static water flow for that area was roughly between 30 and 40 CFS, and that in 2014 we were hovering around 20 CFS. You see these spikes that are downward spikes that are occurring. We project those are major diversions that are occurring along that system. Here we have a graph that depicts temperature and water levels in the North Fork of the Salmon Creek tributary, a tributary to Eel River, and you can see the downward progression from June through August of 2014 and to literally no water. Again, the main stem is Sproul Creek on the East Fork of the Eel River, and above the East Fork of Sproul Creek. Again, the same steady but downward trend. Note the significant peaks and valleys here. I was talking to Scott Bauer about that, and we kind of are hypothesizing that's directly attributed to the daily draw on by cannabis cultivators. Again, no concrete facts at this time, but as you see towards the end of this these series of graphs, you'll see a stream that I'll show you that has no known draw by, here it is right here actually, Grizzly Creek above Stevens Creek. And there's, to the best of our knowledge, no known grows in that area, and see how the peaks and valleys are relatively concise. We don't have that diurnal fluctuation is fairly constant, and we have limited impact. And again, we have water depth of approximately a foot. In 2015, after studying this issue and trying to determine where we were going to go, we had another drought period to deal with, and so we started monitoring trends and looking for where we were going to hit, where we were going to investigate our most significant threat to our fisheries fisheries populations. And so we started looking at the data again, and all of a sudden we realized that in June of this year, we were seeing the Van Dusen River at approximately 50 CFS lower than it was on the historic mean daily static levels. We saw the Eel River at Fort Seward, and again, significantly lower than historic mean daily static levels. We saw Redwood Creek at Oreck, again, significantly low. And we saw the Trinity River, South Fork Trinity River at High and Palm in the same condition. What do we feel is what do we theorize is contributing this? In addition to the drought, we have grows that are larger than ever. Mm-hmm. This grow here was in the Island Mountain area. Last week was documented outside east of Garberville, about 10 air miles east of Garberville. What's contributing to this dewatering aspect? Well, we have streams that are being diverted at an alarming rate. Because we're in the middle of a drought, every drop of water is being drained. We have black polypipe ranging from a half inch to 3 inches. It's draining the flow of these streams. Again, more documentation or depiction, photo depiction of what's going on. And they're transporting this water great distances. The water is being superheated in this black polypipe and really unsuitable for fish if it was ever discharged back into the streams. This situation here, it's really hard to see, but this is up near Fish Lake in Humboldt County. And this was a DTO-style grow. Individuals had 5,000 plants, five primary parcels, and they literally had a mile's worth in approximately 200 to 300 yards stretch of stream and to the grow. They had over a mile or 2 miles of pipe, black polypipe. And they used everything from Dixie cups to visqueen to funnels to liter-sized Pepsi bottles and made funnels and literally dewatered the stream. There wasn't one iota of water left by the time it hit just above that diversion tank there, which dispersed it out into the five to six different grows. There were southern torrent salamander in this watershed. We were able to document those as well. Again, a species of special concern. Another issue that we've come into place to mind with the Island Mountain detail that we had last week, we found numerous sites of new pond construction. These new ponds were not properly compacted. There was no armoring on the ups, on the inflow and outflow. They were prone to disaster at any given time with a good rainfall. You'll see here in the next photograph how the outflow to that discharge pipe, when the water was low, they were basically siphoning the water downstream to lower grow. And here's the outflow. Again, when we have rain, if we have rain, there's no armoring, there's no buffering for the discharge of that funnel, for that culvert, and we're going to have massive sedimentation discharged into the Eel River. Again, we get back to what are the issues we're coming across. Again, this is the Island Mountain area in Mendocino County. We had, again, countless ponds of this nature constructed. This pond in particular, it was 40 feet high on the downstream side. They were diverting water into this pond from into a Class 3 waterway and basically collecting every ounce of water that was there before it started to dry up. And there was a grow right below this one. Again, these ponds poorly constructed, poorly compacted, and you see here the dam beginning to fail, even with the limited rainfall we had this year. We saw other ponds in the same area where we had significant diversion of the stream. Here we have, if you see the culvert up in the top of the stream below the tree line, and you see the stream channel. And again, all this flow is being diverted into this. You see the heavy equipment being parked there on the far right-hand side of the screen. Again, this supplied numerous large grows downstream. Here we have a stream that was moved approximately 20 feet to our right, and that area was completely covered by canopy, according to the Google Earth images of 2014. Another issue we deal with in the cannabis infrastructure development that threatens our aquatic resources would be illegal or improper road construction. Here we have a stream crossing, a culvert thrown in place, no 16 stream bed alteration agreement in place. It's approximately 20 feet across. Ironically, according to Google Earth images and other imagery, we have documentation to show that the major failing downstream. Here you see upstream and downstream, and in the downstream you see that large scouring area there. That's approximately 100 feet in height, and what we had, what happened was a debris, because it was poorly constructed, undersized, we had a debris dam formed above, and this discharge, when it finally failed, scoured that entire ravine or gully.
Mr. Little, I don't mean to interrupt. Sure. We're going to need to, about a couple more minutes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you.
So again, we get to future road crossings, and we have these issues again and again, over and over, stream channel, and poorly constructed, the culvert downstream that was just cast aside because it failed. We have streams. This is a stream channel that in Trinity County that was buried by road construction, another stream channel that was buried by road construction. And then we have the multitude of groves that we're finding daily. As I mentioned earlier, we have the cannabis industry that's own numbers estimate approximately 50,000 groves in California. This is what we have to deal with the problem. I have 7 staff members. I have 2 on loan, 2 additional law enforcement on loan from our watershed our marijuana enforcement team. Today, we've inspected approximately 99 properties. We've inspected 6 counties, Shasta, Hama, Butte, Humboldt, and Trinity County, Mendocino. And we've issued probably in excess of 30 notice of violations, and we're looking close at 10 administrative actions pending. Lastly, we are in a position of getting approximately 90% compliance with our inspections when we're looking at the notice of violations that are filed. Our license stream and alteration agreements are being submitted daily by landowners trying to seek compliance, and water storage businesses in Northern California are booming because of our influence. Our future efforts are to continue our inspections, whether it be consent or warrant, try to protect salmon and steelhead resources, continue our outreach efforts, and try to permit as many of the legitimate grows as possible. And thank you very much.
Lieutenant Little, I just want to say thank you so much, and not at all trying to be pushy, so I apologize. And I got to say, Lieutenant Little knows like no other. He is actually leading the department's newly formed watershed enforcement team, where he is on the ground and working every day related to the destruction of watersheds from these operations. If it's all right, unless you'd like to ask a question, if we can just keep moving, and then we're going to go to Mr. Grayson as well, which we're grateful for you making the drive today. Mr. Grayson is the executive director of the Friends of the Eel River, and he's going to be presenting some of the impacts that he is seeing within that watershed. And again, Mr. Grayson, thank you so much for being here. And Mr. Little, great job. I'm going to have you hang so we can ask questions after the sheriff.
Thank you, Senator McGuire, and thanks so much for having me here and for convening this inquiry, which is continuing the effort to address a really, really difficult policy arena. And I think we need to acknowledge the leadership that Senator McGuire and Assemblyman Wood have directed to this, and we're going to need more of that. I think we've well established that the commercial marijuana industry in its current unregulated form and rapidly expanding scale is overwhelming some of our critical North Coast watersheds. It's driving key fisheries extinct. Those fisheries like the coho in Sproul Creek that Lieutenant Little talked about were pushed to the brink by the impacts of logging and road building in the 20th century, but it's marijuana and its associated impacts that is pushing the species over the edge. As noted, we face a combination of the acute impacts of water diversions and the chronic impacts of sediment inputs. It's like heart attack and cancer. They'll both kill you. They're both fatal. They happen on different time scales and need different solutions. We also need to note that it's human communities being affected. The community of Rio Del, which sits on one of the oldest human sites in the entire Yellow River Valley, faced curtailment notices last year, while thousands of diversions continued above them in the watershed without any registration at all. When I last checked the State Water Board's website for water rights, we had 420 water rights sought total in all of history in the Yellow River Basin. We're looking, as we've all said, at somewhere between 3,000 and 5,000 diversions probably operating in the Yellow River Basin today. So we are quite a ways from being able to use even the inadequate system that Mr. Howard described. I want to note that above all, we really need clear rules in order to get to solutions about what's okay and what's not to help guide these gentlemen in doing their jobs effectively. The North Coast environmental community strongly support legalization and regulation. We think it would make sense to allow homesteads a reasonably sized garden, up to about 2,000 square feet. At larger scales, however, questions of water supply and cumulative impacts get a lot more challenging. And unfortunately, our friends in the commercial cannabis lobby are pushing to legalize these very large-scale operations. And if, as a society, I think we decide that we'd like to see pot grown in large operations, there are certainly environmentally sound ways to do that. But they should be sited on lands suitable for and zoned to accommodate agricultural operations, not deep in the backwoods in the Emerald Triangle. We've been disappointed that our friends in the lobby have failed to address these impacts and these large operations, and frankly, we see in their reaction to the Island Mountain bus some of the reason they've been unwilling to do so. They see these folks not as criminals, but as constituents to be defended. Any state system of pot regulation is going to have to provide both rules and enforcement resources adequate to safeguard water quality and prevent take of listed species. And I have to emphasize that nothing on the table right now, not legislation, not regulation, provides that backstop. We don't have it yet, and we must have it if we are to protect our public trust resources in fisheries and water quality. Finally, I want to emphasize that as difficult as it may seem to rein in this exploding industry today, it is going to be much more difficult to pull back on improvidently granted rights if we go too far right now in issuing new permits. Thank you very much for your attention.
No, thank you so much, Mr. Grayson, and I greatly appreciate it. And I have to say, you've been one of the most outspoken advocates for protecting our rivers and fish from some of these operations. And we really appreciate your advocacy and for you being here today.
Thank you.
And we're going to have you hold here just a bit for any questions. Absolutely. All right. It is now my pleasure to be able to introduce Sheriff Allman. Mr. Allman, his family has been on the North Coast for 4 generations. We're grateful that you left a little before 5 o'clock today to be here at the hearing. And we're going to turn it over to Mr. Allman to be able to talk about some of the impacts that he has seen in Mendocino County, both on the environmental and on the community side. Sheriff, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you for taking time, Senators and Assemblymen, to be here. This is a critical time in our state as we are looking at what may happen next year, and this needs to be on the forefront of everybody's mind to have a proper discussion whether or not how we're going to regulate marijuana. You opened today's hearing, and I appreciate it. The fish flows and marijuana grows, and I am going to put a subtitle of wildlife, water, and weed, because that's what we're seeing in Mendocino County. I'm entering my 35th year of law enforcement, and my wife and I have been very fortunate enough to raise our 2 boys in Mendocino County, and they're both blue-collar workers now, and actually one of them is in his 3rd year of commercial fishing. And we're seeing the drop-off of fishing happening throughout Mendocino County that's affecting, of course, our economy as well as tourism and so forth. In my lifetime, and actually grew up in Garberville in Humboldt County, I remember being a young man, when young boy, when the, if I can use the phrase, old hippies moved into town. And, of course, we all thought the world was going to come to an end then, but it didn't. And little did we know that the people who were moving into southern Humboldt, northern Mendocino in the early 70s were actually setting up responsible, reasonable marijuana grows. I never in a million years thought I'd be sticking up for what was happening back there, but I am. Because the old hippies are not our problem. The problem that we're having now are the 20-year-olds with a sore shoulder who are growing under the auspice of Proposition 215 to try to make their $1 million in a year. And what we saw 2 weeks ago in Island Mountain certainly will be in my mind forever. I thought things were bad, but never until I stepped foot, and I appreciate the assemblyman going up with us, with our district attorney and I, to look and see absolutely face-to-face with the damage that was being caused. In 2011, six counties operated a operation called Operation Full Court Press, and this was strictly on public lands in the Mendocino National Forest, 950,000 acres, where we spent 3 weeks, eradicated 650,000 plants, and we really thought that we had made a difference. But and while we had had removed 42 miles of black plastic pipe and 52 tons of trash during these public land grows, what we saw 2 weeks ago was an in-your-face situation, because these were private lands. With the exception of 11,000 plants that were eradicated off BLM property 2 weeks ago, the remaining portion of the 87,000 plants were eradicated off private land. Private land of people who had been getting away with it for years. These were not cartels. I'm referring to these as rich white people grows who were making millions of dollars because they hadn't been caught. And they were doing everything they could to blow out their business plan if and when recreational marijuana is legalized in California. So what we saw during those 4 days, and what we saw in the lieutenant's slides, and I appreciate you bringing those in, were this the absolute abuse of our natural resources. My family had its roots, no pun intended, in the timber industry. I've seen the timber industry regulated to the point of almost unable to continue. We as a state have regulated the roads, we've regulated the watersheds, we've regulated every portion of the timber harvesting that we see that allows our economy to survive, but very little has been done to regulate the abusive marijuana grows that we're seeing throughout the state, but specifically in the Emerald Triangle. The Emerald Triangle, Trinity, Humboldt, Mendocino County, have seen people move there strictly for the purpose of abusing our land and making as much money as they possibly can. So today we're facing a new threat. We're facing the abuse of our land, we're facing the theft of our water, and we're seeing the thumbing of the nose into law enforcement and society's face. And while society has put an approval, a legal approval on medical marijuana and a tacit approval on recreational marijuana, we're continuing to see people pushing the envelope. And if this body as a whole, as in the state capitol, wants to make a difference in their careers, this is the turning point. This is the watershed moment to make a difference in your career. Because what's going to happen next year if the voters pass recreational marijuana is we're going to see a continued abuse of our land, the clearings of our lands that we see, and a absolutely detrimental effect on our lifestyle throughout the North Coast. And believe me, not everybody in the North Coast grows marijuana. The vast majority of citizens are very responsible, and those who do grow medicinal marijuana that the sheriff's office is aware of do so in a responsible way. So I am going to somewhat stick up for them as much as it pains me to do so. I am going to do that. I want to talk about a couple things. I want to talk about deep water pools where a marijuana grower would literally in a creek or river see a deep water pool. It might be 8 to 10 feet where the fingerlings fish are going to be there, and where fertilizer is just dumped directly into the water. So the water can be pumped from that location to the marijuana. And nobody who was raised in that area would ever do that. Yeah, that's you don't do that in your own backyard. And that's exactly what happened. We've seen 4-inch diversion pipes being put directly into the Eel River. A 4-inch diversion pipe, to give you an idea, can extract 400 gallons per minute of water from the Eel River directly to a holding tank. Matter of fact, the holding tank that you see to my left here, 100 foot by 100 foot, and it's approximately 8 feet tall, I asked a friend of mine who's a mathematician to give me an approximate gallonage of the water tank that you see behind me. And the gallonage was 587,000 gallons of water would be in that. And coincidentally enough, the 87,000 plants that we eradicated 2 weeks ago needed 500,000 gallons of water per day just to sustain. So that much water was being used every day to sustain the marijuana that was being illegally produced in the three counties. Well, that was actually in Humboldt County. That's a Humboldt County deputy that looks like a G.I. Joe, but it's a real guy, and he felt as if it broke, he was going to drown. It was so big. It was off the Eel River, so that one of two ways could that have been filled, either from a stream, a runoff stream in the winter, or most likely a pressurized pump from the Eel River diverting it up there. And it couldn't, the water couldn't be diverted back into the Eel River when it was found because the water, as we've heard so much about the temperature of water, that water was much warmer than what was flowing through the Eel River. So that was the story of that. And we're assuming that bladder is what it's referred to, was manufactured there. It was a very, obviously, a custom. We've never seen anything like it. You can't find one on the internet. Some manufacturing company made one very specifically for that piece of property and for that landowner. And it wasn't removed, but it's still there. So as we face this critical time, all I ask from our state legislature is to continue having a conversation with the people who are impacted. We've certainly heard the Sacramento River flows, how it's impacting them. But I'm telling you, our economy, whether it's timber, whether it's tourism, whether it's the fisheries, it's all being impacted by illegal marijuana growers. And not the legitimate medical marijuana grows. Thank you for the opportunity to be here today, Senator.
Thank you so much, Sheriff. Really grateful, and for all your work as well, and for making the trek. And we're really happy that you're here, along with two others. Thank you so much. We'd like to be able to open it up for committee comments or questions, and why don't we start to the left with the Vice Chair.
Well, thank you, and obviously we've had ample opportunities to interact over the last few weeks, and Scott, really appreciate you being here today. One of my questions is to Mr. Little here. You showed a picture up in Trinity County there of a lot of timber conversions that have happened. My understanding from talking to Trinity County supervisors is that our own CAL FIRE issues permits that allow for 3-acre timber conversions, and they are somewhat ministerial. A fee is paid, and those people go out and clear land and grow marijuana. Is that a fair, from your understanding, is that a fair assessment of what's going on up there?
Yes.
So we, as a state policy, are enabling this illegal activity to occur?
Well, there, from what my, to the best of my understanding, we are providing the opportunity to the cannabis cultivators to do the same clearing that we would anybody else. It's just that they are taking advantage of the situation, and in many times also taking advantage of headwater streams and so forth that are being corrupted by this these diversions. So I've been doing some research into this lately, and so to get nuts and bolts to answer your question is yes, they are taking advantage of a loophole in the system that benefits them.
Because quite frankly, that part of Trinity County now looks like the dark side of the moon, from my perspective. And your flyover obviously more recently shows that has only escalated to the point where we now have thin lines of trees surrounding large cleared areas. So I just wanted to bring that out because I've never heard our state, our CAL FIRE comment on that. But it became aware to me as I was meeting with our Trinity County supervisors that this is what's happening up there. And by our own, you know, we are somewhat enabling this to happen by the way we do that. So Scott, I don't know if you have a comment on that.
I just encourage you to ask the agency, CAL FIRE, that is, how they're tracking those conversions and how they're looking at the potential cumulative impacts of all the conversions they issue in a given area.
We will.
Thank you.
Gentlemen. Mr. Simon. Okay. Just a few comments. I mean, we'll be bringing up Mr. Dwight and Mr. Allen to be able to conclude the panel. And I'm sure we'll have some comments after those two individuals speak. Regardless of what folks may think about medical marijuana, it's legal in California. 19 years ago, Proposition 215 passed. And a promise by the legislature to follow up and implement rules and regulations never happened. So we've allowed this industry to explode. So we've seen cannabis cultivation as well as and consumption explode across the state and nation. And the vast majority of impact are happening in four counties, Lake, Mendocino, Humboldt, and Trinity, with very few resources to be able to protect the public resources that we all enjoy. And do believe that this needs to be the year that legislation is finally passed to bring forward those rules and regulations. And I know some may still feel uncomfortable with the issue of medical marijuana. But how many more years are we going to allow this to continue? And this lack of inaction is jeopardizing entire species within our watersheds. And it's out of control. We have, in Trinity County, on Post Mountain, Cal Fire won't even respond any longer without law enforcement going in first to do a sweep. You know that in Rancho Sequoia in Humboldt County, same thing. Cal Fire won't respond without law enforcement going in first because it's too dangerous. And I really appreciate the vice chair bringing forward the issue of Cal Fire. We've cut Cal Fire staff, so they let out, as the vice chair eloquently stated, they allow these over-the-counter permits for less than $1,000. You can go clear 3 acres, and no one ever follows up. Candidly, no one will follow up because there isn't the staff to follow up, because Cal Fire staff was cut back in 2009 and 10. So, which now we've seen tens of thousands of acres of California forest land cleared. And I know there's a lot of focus on the viticulture industry, wine, there's a lot of focus on timber. At least there are rules and regulations that govern those industries. There's nothing here. And now we're paying the price. And I don't mean to go on the soapbox, and I appreciate the work that the vice chair has been doing with his legislation. We have legislation. There's other legislation moving forward in the assembly. And shame on us if we don't pass it this year. So, yes, please.
Sheriff, 215 legalizes marijuana, but federal law doesn't. Which one do you follow?
As we know from the constitutions, sir, the state and local law enforcement officer can legally enforce state and local laws, and a federal law enforcement enforces federal law. And as a sheriff of Mendocino County, I am a local law enforcement officer, and we can enforce state and local laws. We certainly welcome federal law enforcement officers to come in our county and enforce federal laws on the condition, and while it's only a condition I ask, they surely don't have to follow. If they come in and eradicate and make arrests, we ask that it be prosecuted at the federal level instead of the federal government coming in, eradicating in the name of the federal government, and then when the U.S. Attorney's Office says they're not going to file, then the report would, sometimes they have filed it in the past with our local district attorney. So what we have is we have a workaround of the laws. We have eradicated in the name of the federal government and prosecuted in the name of the state government, where our district attorney and I, we don't agree with. So they're welcome to come in our county as long as they can follow up what they've done. Thank you for asking, sir.
Thank you so much, Simon, Senator.
Well, Sheriff, we've been down this trail a long time, and we've talked about it a lot at North Coast Sheriffs, or North State Sheriffs, again and again and again. And I agree in the need to have some kinds of clear regulation. And to the issue of state and federal at the Border Patrol hearings, we always hearken to both. And if they came in and gave arguments that, they didn't violate state law because it was 215, we'd just say, fine, violated federal law. That's all we need to revoke you. And you know, that was a good lever. But if we're not going to have an enforcement, a sure and certain enforcement, then it's meaningless. And you don't have the resources to really do that. You're trying, though, and I gather you're working with the board, too, providing some security as they go in to do their searches for the identify the diverters and the dangers of that diversion, correct?
We certainly are. Every request we get, we certainly go in.
Sheriff Allman, if you could tell us, what's the most help that the state legislature could provide you as a county sheriff in the next year? And
whatever laws that you're going to pass, make them consistent throughout the state of California. To allow law enforcement to know what the laws are so we can go in and black and white know the violations that we're facing. There are so many portions of the law that are gray laws mm-hmm. that because of Proposition 215's wording, it's allowed a huge gray area to where law enforcement is now being forced to interpret what the law is. Yep. And once again, the civics class said that the judicial branch of our government is supposed to interpret. However, we're interpreting what the legislative branch has done, and that's not what we have asked for. So please, make it consistent throughout the state of California.
Excellent point.
Thank you very much.
I hear that.
Thank you for asking.
Thank you, Mr. Sheriff. I have one last question, then we're going to be bringing up Mr. Dwight and Mr. Allen. Lieutenant Little, this may be back of the napkin, and you may be pulling it out of your ear right now. How much? So I've heard the statistic from Director Bonham that I think approximately 310 peace officer rangers within Fish and Wildlife, and he has said that he could put all 310 on the issue of marijuana and not be caught up. What would it take position-wise to be able to do it right?
Statewide?
Yeah. You want to get back to me on that? I'll bring it back up. But if you want to think about it, and again, just are we talking doubling? Are we thinking another 30%?
Our current team?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm to statewide. I mean, you'd be scratching the surface with 50, and that would be if you said 25 ESs and 25 game wardens statewide. I mean, right now I barely cover. My team is scratching the surface, and we have two ESs and four full-time game wardens, mm-hmm. and so or five, excuse me. But and we've barely accomplished 100 grows this year. And that's a success because we were projected to do 75 in a year, and we're 9 months in.
All right.
When you're talking about, you're talking specifically about your watershed enforcement team, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you, gentlemen. And I'm going to be bringing up Mr. Dwight. Mr. Dwight is a fifth-generation land manager and bee producer in Ferndale. He owns about 8,600 acres on the North Coast, and family has been raising beef cattle since 1850. The Cattlemen Association has been involved in this discussion. And we're also grateful that Hezekiah Allen is here. Hezekiah is the executive director of the Emmer Growers Association. And I want to take a moment to thank Hezekiah. Hezekiah has been involved in the legislative discussions last year. He is neck deep involved this year, and he's traveling across the state to be able to bring forward rules and regulations in which growers can comply with. And we'll say what the sheriff did earlier in a bit of a different form, is that I think the majority of growers, at least on the North Coast, want to be able to comply with state rules and regulations if we had any. And I know that Mr. Allen has been committed on working on that issue. And greatly appreciate it. I would like to be able to turn it over to Mr. Dwight, who is representing the Cattlemen's Association today. Mr. Dwight, we're grateful. The floor is yours.
Well, thank you, Chairman McGuire and committee, for having me here today. I'm going to go back first. I am a fifth generation up there in Humboldt County, and I'm in all those majority of those watersheds, and I work closely with neighbors and members of the CCA, California Cattlemen's Association. One of the things that I've done and that I had to sell to some land managers like myself and beef producers up there is here a few years ago I got on the Coho Recovery Board and learned quite a bit and would go back and talk to members about the fisheries and how important the water quality. We are environmentalists. We are stewards of land. We do want to see these endangered species come back, let alone not to mention the deer and everything else. Over time here, we have seen quite a change in Humboldt, and I'm going to stick with Humboldt. And I'm going to take you back in history here a little bit. In the early mid-1800s, people were settling out in these upper watersheds. They were there to live and have a family and be able to cut timber and move on and have enough water. Over time, things have changed. Timber companies have come in and bought that land. Ranchers have bought the land and acquired larger tracts of land within these upper watersheds, where we're talking about the impacts that we're seeing with the fish. Speed it up to today, what is going on within the ranching community through estate taxes and death? These ranches have to be sold and split. It comes down to money. So they are chunking off these corners of these properties, and who is coming in and buying them? They see an investment here. I'm telling you here today that these upper reaches cannot continue to support these grows. Even back in the 50s, 60s, 70s, on the ranching aspect and timber operation, we would withdraw cattle, sheep, the weather would shut down the logging, and we were out of there and let the watershed heal itself and come back in. There is a group I want to talk about. It's called the Yes Group. They are in the Van Dusen watershed. I want to bring some positive stuff here because this is what we're doing as landowners out there. They have assessed 150 miles of road, treated over 1,030 sites. This encompasses 80,000 acres along with 12 families within this 80,000 acres. They have learned how and trained to use heavy equipment for stormproofing roads. We're talking about a lot of diversions here and about water. We got to continue to think about in this drought. I mean, this is severe. None of us have seen this. But when this rain does hit and these roads that are out there going to these groves, the sedimentation that is going to come rolling off these hills and the landslides, within our business, we do not want to see one drop of soil left off because we never get it back. We are stewards of land, and we, as I heard here today, a lot of great comments. I would support, and I know the California Cattlemen support, to continue to work with communication and education. That's the only way we're going to get a handle on this, and thank you.
Oh, thank you so much, Mr. Dwight. And like I say, we're grateful to the cattlemen who have been working collaboratively on this issue. Know it's impacted many longtime families on the North Coast as well. And we so appreciate you being here today and sharing your perspective. If it's okay, I'm going to have you hold, and we're going to open it up for questions after Mr. Allen. All right, and it is our pleasure to be able to bring forward Mr. Hezekiah Allen, who's the Executive Director of the Emerald Growers Association, who will be providing a report and perspective, and then we'll open it up for questions for the committee. Mr. Allen, welcome.
Thank you, Senator and Assemblymember, Senator. It's an honor and a pleasure to be here today. Hopefully somebody knows how to make this work. While that's happening, I'm going to read something. Section 1.3 of the Southern Oregon Northern California Coho Recovery Strategy, which was finally finalized. Section 1.3, Achieving Recovery. Agencies have neither the funds nor the authority to bring about all the actions necessary to sufficiently improve the condition of this species. Partnerships are a critical component of salmon recovery. Partnerships between landowners, tribes, local, state, and federal government agencies, between non-governmental organizations, landowners, federal, state, local agencies. Our work as an association is driven by this underlying belief that partnership is required to solve these issues. Still fiddling with this, but I will start by introducing myself. I was born and raised in Southern Humboldt County. Growing up, my parents supplemented their income growing cannabis. As a young adult, when I returned from college, I did the same. I owned and operated a successful small medical cannabis farm. I also grew up off the grid. I did homeschool. I could often be found knee-deep in the creek, learning about sediment, fisheries, and all my life I've had an acute understanding of the interplay between rural economies and healthy watersheds. My commitment to a sustainable California is what drives the work that I do today, and I know that we can get there. A year ago, roughly, I moved full-time to Sacramento after spending several years commuting down here to work on these issues. It's a tremendous honor to be here today. It was this committee 4 years ago that I first testified in. And to be full circle back here again is very exciting. I want to mention our trade association statewide, about 750 members, supporters, and partners. We primarily represent small cannabis farms. We're rapidly growing. We have members in 32 counties. This isn't isolated to the North Coast. It's certainly most acute there. Like so many of the farmers I represent, I have had trouble with law enforcement. I have been charged with cultivation. I have gone to court and dealt with this. I've had friends killed. I have friends in jail today because of this problem. This crisis is impacting everyone in our communities, farmers included. Looking forward, we have been actively taking a new approach, trying to build relationships and partnerships with law enforcement and regulatory agencies. But what we've seen in return is a continuation of the drug war, as usual. The Island Mountain raids are a case in point, and we'll get into that in a second. So that was the slide that was supposed to play while I was introducing myself. Now we're on to this. This industry has been in the shadows for a long time, so let's try to put some information to it. Good information, accurate information is critical to good decision making. So we took this 2006 report. It's a pretty good one. It's been cited in several Legend analyses. 8.6 billion pounds, $13.8 billion. I called it 20 million pounds today. It's about doubled since 2006. Let's give it a little bit of change. We have estimated that there are more than 50,000 small farms in California. You see a map here of Southern Humboldt County alone. Department of Fish and Wildlife shows 2,200 of them in half of a county. We also estimate that each of these farms creates 4.8 full-time equivalent living wage jobs. That's an important and often overlooked fact. A small farm is less than a quarter of an acre in production. That's what we've proposed. That's what AB 266, which we're currently supporting, proposes. Top picture, there is 120 acres of land. Humboldt-Mendocino line runs through the middle of it. What you see there is a little white speck. On the bottom, that's the grow. Island Mountain, raided, crop destroyed, farm devastated 2 weeks ago. This is a seventh of an acre. It's well within the definition of a small farm. So let's go ahead and move on. What are we doing here? Between 10 and 20 million pounds of cannabis per year, value of $16 to $32 billion. Just to put this into perspective, we supported the Department of Fish and Wildlife in their request for new authorities in the emergency drought legislation, actively. We took flack from other resource industries for doing so. We support all three regulatory bills proposed this year. We have actively worked with every regulatory agency to open the doorway for our community of farmers. And yes, several of them did have their livelihoods devastated 2 weeks ago. For several years, we've been on the front lines promoting BMPs and water conservation. I'm thrilled to see 500,000 gallons of water stored because that's the solution in the 21st century in California. So how much water is this using? We don't know. 6 gallons per day, that was our number 5 years ago. It was a worst case scenario number. 1 gallon per pound per growing day is a much better number. So I'm going to split this 20 million pounds into two categories, large plants and small plants. In order to achieve 20 million gallons, growing large plants, 5 pounds per plant, 5 gallons per day, it takes 150 days. We're looking at 3 billion gallons to do that. Small plants, a quarter pound per plant, it's going to take 80 million small plants. So next time you hear a high plant count number, ask yourself if that farmer was using a water conservation method, growing more smaller plants. Let's move on. 9,207 acre feet of water, worst case. 5,524 acre feet of water, best case. We're going to call it somewhere in the middle. Compare that to 35 million acre feet of year per year used for agriculture. In 2009, 30,000 acre feet per year was illegally diverted from the Russian River. When is the last time the sheriff was deployed to destroy a vineyard to protect the water resources and fisheries? Revenue, we get $1,308 per acre feet of revenue per year in traditional ag. We get $3.2 million per acre foot in the cannabis industry. Jobs, 100 acre feet per job created, as compared to 0.04 acre feet per job created. I want to tell you simply what won't work. More of the same. The war on drugs has not only failed us, it's created this situation. What we need is inspections. We saw 90% compliance. What we need is business licensing. What we need, most importantly, is access to technical support programs, grant programs, and other existing agricultural programs. When I was the director of the Matole Restoration Council, I managed $7 million in water bond funding. I cleaned up 1,100 road crossing. I didn't, excuse me. Excuse me. I was very honored to play the tail end in these large contracts. We cleaned up over 1,100 road crossings, sediments. These are legacy issues on ranches and timberlands. Again, just in one small watershed, that's what we managed. Will you ensure that Prop 1 funds can come to our farms and ranches as well? It's just a question. Again, raids won't work. Showing up unannounced, showing up with guns, we run, we hide. My parents have been in jail. I've lost friends, I've lost family to jail and to murders over this. We're scared. We've been traumatized for decades of heavy-handed law enforcement. You know what works great? Advance notice. Don't destroy our livelihood and our crop. Keep us in the game. That way we can pay the fees, the fines, and the taxes that we need to pay. And at the end of the day, let us work with consultants and technical support agencies to get this cleaned up, because it needs to be. What you can do? Regulate this product. This is commercial agriculture. Regulate it, goodness please. I agree with the sheriff wholeheartedly in one thing: clarity and consistency. We want to know too. Pass and develop an excise tax program. We would much rather pay taxes than fines. We've actually proposed several of them. Get more resources to the Water Board and Fish and Wildlife. Goodness gracious, they need the staff. We like it when the Water Board calls us and says, can we work with you to solve problems? 90% compliance, I think we heard earlier. Developed a balanced approach. Again, existing incentives and access to those programs should be balanced with compliance with existing regs. We have these regs. And spread the word. Cannabis cultivation is commercial agriculture. It's not a crime. We're farmers, not criminals. We're here to solve problems. And I look forward to partnering with all of you to see the recovery of these species, the prosperity of our communities, and a better future for the state of California.
Thank you so much, Mr. Allen. Grateful, appreciate the presentation. What I'd like to be able to do is turn it over to the committee for questions for Mr. Dwight or Mr. Allen or Crommins as well. Who would like to kick us off? Not all at once.
Mike, thank you both for being here. My question is going to be for Mr. Allen. Appreciate you being here. Appreciate the passion you show about your perspective and. And I know the challenges that you are facing. Couple of questions for you. The $32 billion you talked about, are you talking about medical, or are you talking about the entire industry?
That is the extrapolated street value of the total amount produced in the state of California.
So not medical. Not, so that's the total for all rough.
Total for production. Yes.
Okay, so when so you talked about water numbers up there and you compared them, my back of the napkin, because the slide went by pretty fast, is that based on what I was seeing on the screen, the water usage, while compared to other agriculture is not huge, it's still approaching 10%. Is what I saw up there, unless I missed something.
10% of what? I'm sorry.
10%. It's 10% of what normal agriculture consumes. Did I miss that?
No, it's 5,500. It's 5,000 to 10,000 acre feet, as opposed to 34 million total acre feet. It's a fraction, a very small fraction of a percent.
Okay, then I missed it. I obviously missed it.
Here we go.
Okay, my bad. So I was looking at gallons. I looked at the gallons and compared it to the. So anyway,
nope.
My bad. Okay, I apologize for that. So when you talk about small farms, how do you characterize a small farm? Plants. How do you characterize
a quarter
that?
Of an acre is the threshold that we've proposed.
So on a quarter of an acre, what do people grow on a quarter of an acre, and what does that lead to for as far as resource consumption?
So you know, this is where this distinction is really important. My farm, when I sold it in 2012, was 8,600 square feet. We grew 400 plants on it, and we did it all with 110 gallons of stored water. We didn't divert any. And so when you look at these plant numbers here, if we're forced through a plant count to grow a few very large plants, say a 5-pound plant, then yeah, 5 gallons per day is a very realistic number. And those plants are going to be in the ground for 150 days or so, from May through to November. But if we get the flexibility of what is a much more standard agricultural regulatory framework, area and production. We limit it at a quarter acre and we empower the farmers with more tools and flexibility. We can see significantly, you know, significant water savings. Right here we have almost a 50% water savings just by increasing our total plant count from 4 million to 80 million. The problem with that is current enforcement mechanisms are centered around plant counts. A lot of federal funding for enforcement is driven by plant counts. And so what I've been encouraging people for the last 6 years, grow fewer, smaller plants and harvest in July so that the dry months, there's no competition. Let's be real, there's inherent tension between agriculture and natural resources. We've been encouraging fewer or smaller plants. And here we are seeing that used to vilify us still and again.
Okay. Thank you.
Please, Assemblymember.
Thank you. Mr. Allen, your products, were they used for recreational use or medical use?
When we surveyed our membership, we found that 85% of our members exclusively sold into the medical marketplace. I will not make that claim for the industry as a whole currently. Our membership, I think, is a very, you know, it's a self-selected crowd. We are interested in regulation, obviously. In fact, actively supporting every opportunity we get to be regulated and have a business license like anyone else. I don't know about the industry as a whole. If we're producing 20 million, I would guess 2 million of that is legally consumed in the state. So, you know, this comes to one of the underlying root questions, is that consumer demand and social opinion are out of line with enforcement. And as long as there's a demand for this product, there will be a supply for it. And we really need to get out from under this war on drugs mentality and figure out how to regulate the supply side of this industry so that this demand isn't continuing to drive this public safety, environmental, and small business crisis.
The regulators you talk about, are they local or federal?
I have had the unique experience of working with folks from the National Marine Fisheries Service, from various federal agencies, as well as state, as well as local. Primarily at this point, we're engaged with the Board of Equalization, trying to get the sort of business side of it cleaned up, get the tax accounting side of it cleaned up, as well as the Regional Water Quality Board. We're actively supporting the development of their waiver discharge program. We think that'll be a great start toward getting those clear guidelines that we need.
When you go to court, do they look at you under the California law or federal law?
California law, in my case.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Assemblyman. Mr. Senator?
As far as the your cattle operation, are you having difficulty with depredation too, of your livestock? I mean human, not animal. We have plenty of animal too, but are they killing livestock? We have a lot of problems with that around the state.
Yes, there is, but how do you prove it and who's doing it? The one that we've seen here in the last 2 years in the fall, are the dogs that are turned loose.
Feral dogs.
And how do you prove whose dogs they are? But you got a pretty good idea of where they're coming from.
I get you. They're not cow dogs.
No.
That's for sure.
And not to mention the wildlife, because a number of these ranchers depend on, they'll have hunting clubs too. So,
what about the personal security of you and your employees? I know that's a problem for the recreating public in a lot of these areas. They encounter people who are not, too friendly.
Yeah, I mean, you get a pretty good feel for what's going on out there. I invite any and all of you to come up in the fall. You can feel it in there. When I'm approached at a gate last August for $800 for a truckload of water. Mm-hmm. I have no idea who he was. I kind of shook my head and laughed.
$800, huh? I remember years ago when I put the first money in the budget for the camp program, flying up the Feather River Canyon and hearing the ping, ping, ping on the helicopter. The pilot said, well, the natives are restless, but we know where they're at now. That's not humorous, because it's gotten far more difficult now. Sir, you were talking about the regulation. What sort of a regulatory framework? We've seen many. Assemblyman Amiano had a number of bills here to create a marijuana board, so to speak. And what sort of a formal regulatory structure would you advocate?
Quite frankly, we would take anything at this point. You know, I hate to admit that, and I know that some of my members will be frustrated with me for saying it, but where we are now isn't okay. Something needs to change. Both, you know, our chair and our vice chair have legislation currently active. We are supporting both of those bills. Similarly, Assembly members Bonta, Cooley, Jones, Sawyer, and Lackey have a comprehensive regulatory bill. We're supporting that as well. You know, a few key provisions that we really are, you know, non-negotiable from our perspective is this acknowledgement that this is agriculture, and the best way to regulate it is that similar to the way that we regulate other agriculture. You know, this idea of destroying a crop, if the first enforcement action is to destroy our crop, that's pretty difficult for a farmer. So we want to be regulated like other food and ag. We're also very insistent on a system of tiered business licensing. We represent primarily small farms. Believe it or not, there are some farms bigger than a quarter acre out there. And, you know, those are going to require an entirely different regulatory approach from our perspective. But up to that quarter acre threshold, we'd really like to see that be the highest priority. We like small farms. We like small businesses as sort of just a conceptual. We think that those small businesses are more likely to be in touch with their communities and integrated into, you know, the way of life there. So tiered business licensing is definitely something that we firmly advocate for. Something that the senator picked up on in his bill, appellation controls. You know, Napa wine comes from Napa County. For 40 years, Humboldt County or Nevada County or Stanislaus County or any one of these 32 counties that I have members in, there's farmers there that insist that their county has grown the best cannabis in the world. And let's protect that. And I just want to note on the issue of public safety. Personally, I've never owned a firearm. I did... purchased one once, but after my 10-day waiting period, I got cold feet. And so this idea of the public safety crisis isn't us. It's not our membership, and it's not most of the farmers out there. But there is a definite public safety crisis. Like, yeah. I said, I've lost friends to it.
I'm sure it would not be yours, and I appreciate your candid remarks about a regulatory framework. The idea of appellation would be kind of different. Maybe some decade ahead, that'll come. I would imagine Mendocino would be like Napa, that you do the premium qualities, and I gather there are types of marijuana that I wouldn't even wildly imagine. The marketing of your product, do you market through the co-ops primarily?
Our membership does, yes.
Yeah, okay.
You know, and that's something that we think a regulatory framework could help clean up. The lack of clarity surrounding business structure, surrounding exactly how we're allowed to organize. Currently, you know, businesses aren't supposed to make a profit. Currently, businesses are supposed to operate as sort of a quasi-commercial exchange. And, you know, that would work great if this were maybe a few million dollar industry. But when you start looking at the level of sales and transactions taking place, we think it's very important that the industry be allowed to form and organize and act as any number of legal entities. So currently, yes, and quite frankly, that is part of the challenge of bringing sense to this industry.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Senator. Vice Chair.
Yeah, I just had a follow-up question. And we hear lots of differing opinions on some things. And I don't know, from your perspective, how much of the industry does your organization represent?
Well, you know, let's be fair. At this point, with 50,000 farms and 250 farmer members, about, you know, a slightly larger fraction of a percent than the total water we use in the state. I think there's a lot more farmers like us that we're trying to get to. Yeah.
So how, and from your perspective, and you know, you may not be able to answer this question. I don't know who can answer the question, but you know, we'd like to believe that lots of farmers would like to come out and comply. We would like to believe that, and that's the premise that I have operated on when I've been working on this issue. If we can create a regulatory framework that allows the medical marijuana cultivators to actually comply with best management practices around water and wastewater and the like, mm-hmm. that we will ultimately be able to draw more people to do that. Mm-hmm. But do you have a perspective of how percentage-wise, how many people will simply not want to follow that?
I don't, but I can suggest a filtering mechanism. Advance notice of an inspection. If the landowner returns a call, that's a pretty good indication that they're ready to get into the system. you know, from the best of my knowledge, what I've seen in the media reports, there were 24 warrants served at Island Mountain. I've since been contacted by 7 of those landowners who said, we actually didn't know there was a problem. Why didn't they call us like they did in Sproul Creek? And I don't have a good answer for that.
Okay. Great. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chair. Just a few comments, and we'll probably ask you to both of you to comment back. I think that anytime an industry goes unregulated for so long, we see what's happening here in California. So whether this is an issue of medical marijuana or manufacturing, food production, you name it, we've allowed this industry to grow, to and expand completely unregulated, which has allowed a significant criminal element to take hold. And entire economies on the North Coast for now 2 generations have been built on cannabis. You have multi-generational cannabis farmers in Humboldt and Mendocino and Lake and Trinity. And now what's being overshadowed is the significant criminal element and the tens of millions of dollars that are being pumped in, as the sheriff had said, is expanding some of these grow operations. And the reason why we don't have any squishy, or the reason why we have squishy numbers, we can't nail down how much water is being used and how many grow sites are out there, is because we're unregulated. And this is insane. This state would never allow any other industry to go for so long. I don't understand why there isn't an outcry. We've heard stories in Trinity County that in the post-Mountain Trinity Pine area, that you had large criminal growers actually shut down county roads during harvest and not allow neighbors to return. And they're armed. Why are we allowing this in California? With Prop 215, there's a lot of good in 215, but it's also created a patchwork of 58 different ordinances. Some counties don't even have ordinances. And it is not only frustrating to the cultivators, to the dispensary owners, but it's also frustrating to law enforcement as well. And again, I'm just blown away why we'd allow this to take hold for so long without any rules or regulations. I want to wrap it up with this. We need significant resources to be able to repair the damage that's been done over the last 20 years and to ensure that we've learned our lesson from the last 20 years of non-regulation. And what I'm hoping is that this is going to be the year that the legislature is going to have the backbone to set aside the personalities, set aside the politics, and pass comprehensive medical marijuana regulation. And the governor is going to have to sign it. We can no longer afford to put our heads in the sand. And our communities in Northern California, throughout California, are paying the price. Our environment is paying the price. The public safety is paying the price. Too many people have died over the expansion of this industry. So what I'm hoping is that this is going to help be a springboard today to move this issue forward. And even though there may be some discomfort related to the issue of medical marijuana, it's legal, and we're not turning the clock back. And individuals who want recreational use, you're going to have your say probably in 2016. But what I would hope is it would be the wrong decision and not putting that regulatory framework in now and letting it be dictated via a proposition, because that's how we frankly got into this mess that we're in today. I don't know if any of you want to, either of you want to comment on that, good or for bad.
Hear.
All right. So Dwight.
I agree. I mean, got the ball rolling. It took us this long to get there, and I think there is movement here to help with land use issues and the cultivation of marijuana. And I mean, we can all get along here, and it's all going to work out.
Absolutely, and I think that to ignore this is also a significant economic driver. It's a multi-billion-dollar industry. The Assemblyman and I worked with an individual who open up a hardware store out on the coast, and the number one client and customer from medical marijuana growers. And there would a lot of the Northern California economy would not be what it is today without medical marijuana. We're going to take a five-minute break. We have some sandwiches, I believe, out in the hall, and allow you a restroom break as well as we've been moving. We're going to come back and open it up for public comment, and then we'll have some closing comments from the committee. So sandwiches are out in the hall. I am offended that no one has eaten the sugar that we have brought in, so please hit that up. And we're going to come back at 1:10. At 1:10, we're going to come back together. Thank you. All right, everybody, we're going to be coming back together.
Okay, I got all our presentations, too. How'd you feel?
All right, we're going to be coming back together. So what we're going to be doing here, ladies and gentlemen, we are going to be opening it up for public comment. We're going to ask that individuals please keep your comments to 2 minutes, and then we'll be looking for closing comments from the committee. We have a microphone right here, and please come on up. And if you could just please state your first and last name, along with the organization. And again, we're really grateful that all of you would stick with us today and have this important conversation. So who would like to be able to come join us first? Come on up. It's good to see you.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you for being here.
My name is John Anderson with the Jerry Mello Foundation. And about 3 years ago, we were jumping up and down about this issue as we were seeing the impacts in Mendocino County and in Humboldt County. And Jerry Mello was a mayor of Fort Bragg, past city council member, a mentor to myself, and he was murdered investigating the illegal trespass grows in the county. And any future regulations need and legislation need to take that into account, that even though we do pass something for medical marijuana, we're still going to have an illegal underground operation. Colorado's told us that. And as long as it's still illegal in Nevada and some of our neighboring states, then we'll have some issues. During the daytime, my normal job is with Mendocino and Humboldt Redwood companies, and our employees have been harassed and threatened by these growers on our own land. And our business plans for the summertime have had to be changed because of these operations. And again, I know that this is a little bit separate from what we were talking about today, but I am being very specific about illegal trespass grows, but need to keep those into account too. Thank you.
No, thank you so much. And I want to take a moment to say thank you to the Mello Foundation. They have been a fantastic resource. And Mayor Mello was just an amazing leader in Fort Bragg. We're really grateful that you'd be here today. Please give our best to Madeline. And thank you for all of your incredible work and advocacy as well. And we're just so grateful that you'd be here today. All right, it's good to see you. Who would like to, please come on up, sir, if you could just give us your name.
Mr. Chairman, my name is Roger Morgan, founder of the Take Back America campaign. I've been engaged in drug prevention work kind of nationally for the last 20 years. A couple of things. The focus of this meeting obviously was on the impacts on the planet, and obviously that's a serious problem. What I believe you have to look at also is the impact on people. Under the guise of medicine, we've had marijuana being sold in various forms, potency that goes off the chart. And from what we know scientifically today about the impacts of the human brain, if we destroy the population, then everything else we're doing has no significance. And by your own admission, when California supplies 60% of the marijuana to the nation, that's not legal. I think we got to look at federal law. As a Californian, we're Americans first, but the impact nationally by what we're doing is very serious. The other thing is you look at regulations in California, which I think is necessary. There are some people that would benefit in a greater manner than the harms inflicted on them by marijuana. So if we stick with the intent, the voters' intent of 215, I think you could eliminate all dispensaries and cultivation sites in California. And most communities don't want them anymore. It's not just an ecological problem, it's an environmental problem. It's impacting communities, public health and safety. So a couple of things. The regulatory aspect is okay. I think if the state had one cultivation site with regulations on the product, you would be ahead of the game. And if you can elevate the age limit from 18 to 21 for medical marijuana, it'd be very critical.
No, thank that's you. Really good. Roger, thank you so much for taking the time to be here today, and we really appreciate your perspective and for providing the feedback. Ms. Dubé.
Ann Dubé with the Sonoma County Water Agency, and Mr. Chairman and members of the committee, thank you so much for holding this hearing. We just wanted to, although Sonoma County does not have the kind of problems that we see up in the northern part of the state, we do have a lot of illegal marijuana grows. And the Water Agency is implementing a biological opinion that was issued in 2008. We're spending an estimated $70 million on habitat enhancements, fisheries, monitoring and studies, several other management and hardware changes. And we work with many, many partners, including the RCDs, the state agencies, federal agencies, on fisheries recovery, specifically related to the Russian River Coho broodstock program, which is turning into a regional recovery program. And when we see tributaries drying up, which really prevents the whole purpose of this program, which is to get the coho up into their native streams and spawning in those native streams, we feel like the millions of dollars, the staff time that we're spending, and the staff time and money invested by all of our partners is really in question. So anything that you can do to help with illegal grows is very appreciated. We feel that marijuana needs to be treated like other agriculture that has setbacks and other kinds of limits on it. We're also very supportive of Department of Fish and Wildlife's efforts to get Prop 1 money out the door quickly and its focus on anadromous fisheries. So thank you again for holding this hearing, and please let us know if you have any questions. Thanks.
Thank you so much for being here, and we're grateful that you made the trek. And please give our best to everybody at the agency.
I will.
Thank you so much. Good afternoon. It's good to see you.
Good afternoon, Chair and members. I'm Pablo Garza with the Nature Conservancy, and I just also want to echo the thanks for for the leadership you guys have demonstrated here and for holding this hearing. And I remember when Prop 215 was passed, this issue of the environmental impacts from marijuana cultivation or for legalizing medical marijuana was never discussed. At least I don't recall it being discussed. And there hasn't been a lot of attention on it in the years past. I think it's gradually weaving its way into this consciousness, and we're having a more robust discussion here in the legislature this year. And I think that has a lot to do with the leadership of this committee and others in the legislature. So thank you again for highlighting that. I would like to bring to your attention, I've shared this with your offices, two scientists from the Nature Conservancy in partnership with California Trout Unlimited and UC Berkeley recently published this paper, High Time for Conservation, Adding Environment to the Debate on Marijuana Liberalization. I wish I could take credit for that title. I can't, but I like it. I did leave a few copies in the back, and I think there's a lot of agreement with what the findings of the paper with the discussion you've been having here today. But primarily any discussion about whether legislative or initiative that goes forward and looks at a more comprehensive regulatory structure for medical marijuana, recreational marijuana, needs to consider the environmental impacts of cultivation to water supply, to forest clearing, the rodenticide chemical use, et cetera. And I think you've got a good discussion today. And finally, a big part of that is funding. And so you need funding for law enforcement. I don't think we'd really need a lot of new laws on the books, but we need to enforce the existing laws. And that'll be funding for Department of Fish and Wildlife, Water Resources Control Board, local law enforcement, et cetera. And I think, that's a key part of it. And I just want to do one final thank you to the Department of Fish and Wildlife for their work on this. And we look forward to working with you and the agencies going forward.
No, thank you so much, and it's great that you've been here all day, so thank you so much.
Thanks for the sandwich, and I am going to
take it. Hey, there we go. Absolutely. Please. Those are my favorites, so watch out. Welcome.
Hi. I also thank you for having this hearing. My name is Ellen Comp. I'm the Deputy Director of the California Branch of NORML, the National Organization for the Reform of Marijuana Laws. I've been around since the 70s. And working with Kristen Nevidal, who does the patient compliance program for Americans for Safe Access, and also some of the figures from the Emerald Growers Association, I came up with a handout that has some calculations that we did about the amount of water used statewide for cannabis. And I have this little chart here. This has the almond crop in California, rice, grapes, tomatoes, and down here is cannabis, which we estimate at about 12,000 acre feet, so in line with what Hezekiah was saying, versus almonds, for example, that use 3.7 million acre feet in California every year. And so cannabis uses just about 0.3% of just the almond crop. And also we did, you know, if you look at like a serving, like a hamburger, one hamburger uses this many gallons of water, and cannabis uses a very small amount if you look at serving. So I agree. I came into this as an environmentalist. I was a hemp activist. So I am very concerned, as anyone in the room, I think, about the problem with the fisheries, and I listened very closely to what they were saying. All the fishery experts were talking about problems in Sacramento, Shasta, the Klamath, but now we're focusing on Humboldt because, as one environmentalist told me, he can't get traction on any other environmental issue these days because everybody just wants to talk about marijuana and how it's ruining the environment. So I want to make sure we have some perspective about it. We're all for regulation. We've been for it for all these years. You're right, Mr. McGuire, it was in 2015. We asked the state for regulation. We hope we're going to get it this year. You know, I also worked for Friends of the Eel for a little while, and I remember when what they were working on was the decommissioning of Pillsbury Dam. Yeah. and getting the Sonoma Water District, you know, the eel flows north, and the wineries and all the different places take the water out of the eel before it ever gets to Humboldt County. So let's go for everyone's water rights, sure. Everyone that wants to be regulated in this market. And the criminals don't care about more fines or more penalties. I think what the problem is, it could impact the person who's trying to be in compliance. And the new emergency regulations are removing the window of compliance, and that's a big problem for us.
Absolutely.
Thanks.
Hey, thank you so much for your words and for all of your advocacy as well. We're grateful that you're here.
Thank you.
Thank you. Hey, how you doing? It's good to see you again, and thank you for hanging with us.
You talking to me?
Yeah.
Richard Ginger, committee. Yeah, so there's going to be a fisheries forum later on, right?
Yes.
Okay, that's good.
A little bit of transition with Zeke, and so yeah,
I guess the first I heard, I had a suspicion that Zeke was maybe had some health issues.
Yeah.
His confirmation today, and Zeke's been a guiding light for a whole lot of people, a lot of organizations also, and I hope he fares well.
And we'll be having the reception later this fall.
Good.
Yeah, thank
good.
You.
When I grew up smoking marijuana, it was the unmoney. And I'm not very comfortable with marijuana being accepted as being money. This is a difficult situation. And I haven't been four generations in Humboldt County, but I've been more than four or five in the country. But I moved here and raised a family starting in 1971. And I would like, there's a lot of different little points that came up today, these assumptions. For one thing, the timber industry was not really regulated until about 1975. You know, so that was like 120 years of no regulation, okay? So that to change something over, and also depletion continues in the timber industry. We're at another round of high grading, and only now the high grade is 16 inches in diameter conifers. This problem that we're facing is a much deeper thing than just enforcing a certain class of people doing a certain class of bad practices. It needs to be not just marijuana, it needs to be for people living on the land, what do they need to do? To divert properly, to store properly? The marijuana thing has been singled out. And you should know, and I think you do, that the North Coast, these so-called cultures rejuvenated the whole territory. you know, the volunteer fire departments, community health centers, schools, all that. You know, we're not talking about irresponsible things. And so that it frightens people when you're heavy-handed on this enforcement thing because, for instance, there's been no building permits issued in these rural areas of these rural counties since time immemorial kind of thing. Everybody is vulnerable. Who, you know, Mendocino County still doesn't have a grading ordinance, you know? There's certain basic human respect and constitutional issues. The Director Bonham touched on some of these emergency regulations. It's like, I don't like going through a Willits and getting a paper saying that Veal River is dried up because of marijuana farmers. I don't like exaggerations. This Nielsen subdivision, it's a small portion of the Sproul Creek watershed. And Sproul Creek, we're in a Mediterranean climate. Sproul Creek, the Mattole have historically gone dry. The summer when we moved to the upper Mattole there, they had to truck water into Whitethorn because there wasn't enough water in the river and there was no cultivation seen at the time. We need to be careful about this. If you really want to get to protect a small grower, I got a kick out of Wayne Hansen, sheriff in Humboldt, pointed out there was a woman who had 50 plants and they bypassed her.
Yeah, I'm going to need you just to conclude in about 30 seconds. I apologize.
Okay. Yeah. But you need to go about this in taking into account some of the context I'm trying to give you.
Absolutely.
Because the people there have a sense of place, have been dedicated to that sense of place, and there wouldn't be the King Range Wilderness, there wouldn't be Sinkione Wilderness. People wouldn't even notice about that stuff. And there's a strong, dedicated group of people on the restoration of the Mattole that he mentioned. Roughly, you saw Redwood Forest. Over $2 million just to restore just the sediment from roads in one planting watershed. This is a big situation and needs to be handled much more comprehensively.
No, thank you so much and really appreciate your comments. It's good to see you. Okay, thank you so much, Assembly Member. Thank you for being here all this time. It's great to see you. Hey, nice to see you.
Hi, Julia Carrera. I'm a neutral third-party inspector and I represent the Small Farmers Association. Thank you, both Assemblyman Wood and Senator McGuire, for taking leadership for the North Coast in addressing this issue, the environment, and all agriculture. It's not just marijuana, as several of the people have pointed out already. I just wanted to make a few comments. We have data. I've been inspecting medical marijuana gardens first with Sheriff Tom Allman, who hired me to do that, and now with the Small Farmers Association for 5 years. We've got data that is a little different than some of what the government officials' data is using. And we'd like to get that cleared up. We can supply you with whatever you need. But when it comes to water usage, we have to really look at it carefully because how much water you need on a tomato plant in Humboldt County is very different than how much water you need on a tomato plant in Santa Monica or in Ojai. So we need to look at averages. I think the 6 to 8 gallons per day is a little high. There might be that kind of situation in more desert situations, but we run our farmers, we're about 630 farmers right now. Small farmers, we define small farmers as family owned and operated with 5 employees or less. We don't go into the acreage, we all grow. Monocropping is not sustainable, so anything that grows one crop, in our opinion, vineyard marijuana or anything else, is not sustainable. Our farmers grow their medicine along with vegetables, animals, and orchards. We're using anywhere between 1/2 to 1 gallon per plant per day on the days that need water. Mind you, we do have a drought policy that we require all our farmers to follow, and that's how we got to there. That doesn't mean that there aren't some farmers that need to use more. There are, especially in Southern California or in our drier climates here in Sacramento. The other issue I wanted to talk about was small versus large plants and water usage. I appreciate my colleague Hezekiah Allen pointing that out. I did want to clarify a little bit. When we look at small plants, what those are light depth. So what you're doing is you're altering the growing cycle of a plant. And so you're growing in shorter periods of time, so it takes less water. But you're doing more than one cycle, unlike an outdoor grow. So typically, in our farms, people that are growing in this way, on average, grow 3 cycles. So you end up actually using more water. 4 is quite common and is going to be more common as we see the industry. try to prepare themselves for commercialization. These small farmers who are afraid they're going to lose their homes because people are growing 4, 5, 6 greenhouses full of marijuana that they've been using, as this gentleman pointed out, the land well, they've been using their water well, and they've been using their finances well, and now they're faced with possible extinction because people are coming in. Some people that have already been there are amping up, and we've got to look at that. That's an important factor. Thank you very much.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. I'm glad you're here. Thank you for the feedback and the conversation today. Thank you. Anyone else like to be able to address the committee? We welcome you to come up at this time. All right, we're going to bring it back to the committee, and for closing comments, we're going to turn it over to kick us off to Vice Chair Assemblymember Jim Wood.
Well, great. Well, thank you, Senator McGuire, and the audience for being here today. I think that we've all learned a lot, and this is a very, very complicated issue. I couldn't agree more that the 19 years since Prop 215 passed and where we are today has been way too long. We really need to begin to regulate this industry, and it really needs to begin this year. Faced with the possibility that we will have legalization for recreational use in 2016, without a sound beginning to a regulatory structure around what is legal in California law around medical marijuana cultivation, I fear that we will see an explosion of an industry well beyond what we experience now. I believe, and my experience in speaking with small growers and folks that like Emerald Growers represents and Julia, that there are definitely people who are trying to do the right thing. And the basis for the watershed enforcement team is around helping people come into compliance to do the right thing. It's important that as you look at regulating an industry that has not been regulated and has exploded in growth, that as we look at regulatory policies and as we look at taxation, which inevitably comes with that, all of the things that come with legitimizing business as we know it in California, that we do it in a thoughtful, systematic, progressive way. One of my fears is that an industry that has been completely unregulated, immediately saddled with a huge regulatory burden, will go further underground. And so I don't believe that we are looking, you know, people look at this as a green rush potentially for folks out there. And I think there's lots of folks out there who would love to get their hands on some of the resources. If we are truly dealing with a $32 billion industry, there are effects. There are social effects. There are economic effects. There are environmental effects. There are effects that we probably didn't even know about at this point. But you cannot have a $32 billion industry that does not have consequences. And it's incredibly, it's just amazing that we have gone so far and let this go so long to the point where we are now faced with almost a hard deadline in 2016 as we go forward. You know, the senator and I are, you know, two freshman legislators. Maybe we're both too dumb to know any better, but, you know, this area is a big deal for us. This is our home. This is the area we represent, and it's deeply personal to both of us that we actually make progress on this. It's deeply personal that we create a structure, that we protect the environment, that we restore the environment, that people are able to go out and feel safe in their communities, feel safe in on public lands. And we are going to continue to fight this battle for as long as we are here, I believe. So I hope that we honestly get a good regulatory framework coming forward this year. For the first time, you have multiple bills in multiple houses moving forward at much later in the process than we have seen in a long, long time. And that gives me tremendous hope. So it's an honor to have the ability to work with my colleague in the Senate. We share a lot of the same interests. Our bills are different, but they share elements that are really, really important to all of us. And I look forward to that continued collaboration as we move forward and hopefully create a structure that can work for all of us in California and deal with things. You know, and I'm hearing more recently about the challenges of the human brain, especially in young children. We, as an initiative process goes forward for this, we need to be considering that. While I have obviously strayed from fish and flows here in this closing, it is all related, and it is hard to separate that, and is a very, very complicated subject. So I can't thank the senator enough for putting this together today. I can't thank all of you enough for being here. I really appreciate it, and we'll turn it over to him as I have to go off and testify in committee. So thank you.
Thank you. Okay. I do want to say thank you to Assemblymember Wood for all of his work, and he's absolutely right. Complementary legislation that is advancing, and wanted to say, Mr. Wood, thank you very much for all your work today. A few other thank yous very quickly is one, just wanted to thank all the members of the committee for coming together and our panelists for taking so much time today. And many of our panelists traveled from far and wide to be able to be here today, so thank you so much. I also want to do another shout out to Tom, Mr. Westlow, chief consultant for the committee. You kick tail, sir. Thank you so much for all your work, as well as Kyle Lane from our office, who helped get today's events organized. The sergeants are always amazing, and appreciate all the work that went into today. So thank you so much, gentlemen, and thank all of you for being here and sticking with us. I'm going to quickly discuss medical marijuana, and then finally on drought. The time for talk is gone, right? The time for talk was 20 years ago. And now it's time to take action. And we need comprehensive legislation in 2015. And it's time to follow through with a promise that was made to California voters 20 years ago. And that promise was that once 215 was going to be passed, that rules and regulations governing this industry would follow. And for reasons above our control today, politics and a lot of personality, it never happened. We don't have any more excuses. And frankly, the longer we wait, the worse of an impact that we're going to see related to environment in our communities. So I hope that you are going to be joining with us this year to be able to advance this comprehensive legislation. And ultimately, it is my belief we need one bill. That would be the easiest to follow for this state, the best when it comes to a regulatory framework. On the issue of drought, I don't want to make any assumptions, but I'm a believer in climate change. And I think that it is going to negatively impact this state. And I'm deeply concerned, as we've seen, as we're looking at entire species moving towards extinction in the state of California because of the impact of the drought. And I think it's time for us to be able to change that way. And we're going to need to work together to be able to get through this crisis related to fisheries. Again, thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen, for taking the time. We have extra goodies that you need to hit the road with today. And we greatly appreciate all of your conversation and feedback. Last item is we're most likely going to have another hearing in the fall that will be following up on this related to the issues of drought, particularly on the on the fall run and some of the follow-up items that were discussed and how we can follow up to ensure a successful fall run. Thank you so much, and we are officially adjourned.